present Derek Nimmo, Clement Freud, Peter Jones, and Sheila Hancock in just a minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello and welcome to Just a Minute. And once again, we're pleased to have Sheila Hancock with us in the fourth chair, which we have our visitors competing against our three regulars. And as always, I'm going to ask them to speak, if they can, for just a minute on some unlikely subject without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject which is on the card in front of me. And we'll begin the show this week with Peter Jones. The subject, getting pinched. Can you talk on that? Just a minute. Starting now.
Getting pinched, in the sense that it means tweaked, is not too difficult if you're a girl and in your 20s. However, if you are approaching middle age, as I am, then it's not so easy.
Spirit Nemo's challenge.
Point of information, is Peter Jones a girl?
I don't see what the challenge is, then.
Well, if he is, he's devious. And if he's not...
What is your no,
well,
he said a girl of 20, but I'm approaching middle age. It's not, I mean...
Oh, I think he got it quite well established in my mind that someone was coming up to pinch him. I don't know if it was a fellow or a girl, but he was going to be pinched anyway. And it doesn't matter. He was going to get someone put those two fingers together. I mean, you could have had him for deviation on approaching middle age, yes, but... Peter, I disagreed with the challenge, so you get a point for that, and you keep the subject, and you have 46 seconds on getting pinched, starting now.
If, on the other hand, you mean arrested, then that's quite easy. Go on the underground at rush hour, and you can't really move very much, particularly your extremities, without coming in contact with somebody, and that very often gives rise to objections on the part of the opposite sex, or even the same one in this enlightened age. But this is one of the problems of travelling in London today.
Derek Nimmo, chap.
Abolition of London.
Yes, you did say it before, Peter. So, oh, Derek, yes. You have a point for a correct challenge, and there are 19 seconds on getting pinched, starting now.
So I rushed into the Earl's Court Road and got hold of this brick and threw it through a greengrocer's window, much to the surprise of Mrs. Taylor, whose birthday it was, who was standing inside. The policeman came along and put his hand on my shoulder and said, "I arrest you in the name of the law."
I don't believe you ever did that, Derek. But anyway, nobody challenged you, so you kept going. You got a point for speaking when the whistle went. You've taken the lead at the end of that round. And Sheila Hancock, your turn to begin. The subject, marketplace swindles. I'm sure you can tell us something interesting on that subject. Just a minute, starting now.
Well, to be perfectly honest, I can't. I have never, to my knowledge, been swindled in a marketplace. In fact, speaking personally, I would always much prefer to shop with fellas on barrows than I would in a large supermarket, where I do often feel I'm being swindled when I see labels on top of other labels that show...
Clement Freud is challenged.
Sorry, yeah. Repetition of labels.
You saw too many labels, I'm afraid. Clement Freud, a correct challenge, and there are 38 seconds. Marketplace swindles starting now.
I think the most interesting marketplace swindle I've ever encountered was in Martinique, where a chap was doing the three-card trick, and his colleague was swindling the general public by marking the playing discs, which his...
Derek Nimmo's challenge.
Deviation. Cards aren't discs. He's trying to find another word for it, but they're not discs.
I think that three-card trick, yes, you're quite right, Derek. 20 seconds on marketplace swindles starting now.
The most interesting marketplace swindle that I have ever seen was in Colombo last summer in Sri Lanka, or Ceylon, as it used to be known, where we have an awful lot of listeners. And there I was standing when a man came up to me and said, "Can I change for you those dollar bills that you have?" And he put them into an envelope and took them away inside. He was going to illegally exchange them.
Derek Nimmo got a number more points in that round. He's increased his lead at the end of the round. And Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin. The subject, rude awakenings. Can you talk on that for just a minute? Starting now.
I've had an awful lot of rude awakenings. But you say starting now. You did say starting now. Sorry.
Repetition of starting now.
Yes, sir. I thought
you repeated starting now, I'm afraid. And so Clement Freud has a correct challenge. And you have 57 seconds on rude awakenings, Clement, starting now.
Starting now.
Derek Nimmo's challenge.
Hesitation.
No. You tried hard, but you didn't succeed. There are 55 seconds on rude awakenings, Clement, starting now.
I have an alarm clock which makes one of the most obscene noises I've ever heard. Set it for 6:30 a.m., and half an hour before the clock would have struck 7, had it done so, which it won't, the most extraordinary racket emanates
Derek
from
Nimmo
the
hesitation.
Yes. Silence from the clock. Derek, a correct challenge. 37 seconds on rude awakenings starting now.
Doing little harm to man nor beast.
Sheila Hancock has challenged.
Well, you stopped me once for sort of...
I agree with you, Sheila. Hesitation. And you have 34 seconds on rude awakening starting now.
When you are in a deep sleep and somebody says, get up, show a leg, I consider that...
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Well, you got me for a little hesitation.
No, no, you stumble, which we've established if you stumble...
I shouldn't stumble.
Not enough for a real hesitation.
Oh,
Sheila, you have another point, and you have 28 seconds on rude awakening starting now.
A very rude awakening, or if somebody stark naked...
Peter Jones has challenged.
A repetition of somebody.
Yes, and Peter, you have 19 seconds on rude awakenings starting now.
Somebody going in your ear is one of the nastiest things that can happen to anybody early in the morning, and I always object to it. Even at holiday camps where they have those chimes, I feel the awakening is a trifle rude because it's followed by the excited squeals of one's fellow campers and the sounds of tiny feet, some even large ones, tramping up and down.
Peter Jones kept going very well then, still speaking when the whistle went, though he was running out of breath, and he got some points in that round, and Derek Nimmo's still in the lead. And Clement, your turn to begin, and the subject, Gemini. Will you talk on that for 60 seconds, starting now?
When I was small, I had a pony called Gem, and Gem and I had some absolutely fantastic afternoons, mostly riding on the heath at Walberswick, but occasionally on whole day outings to Dunwich, even to Aldeburgh, sometimes to Snape. Gem and I having been entered by my mother for all sorts of East Suffolk horse shows.
Sheila Hancock challenged.
I was just going to say Gemini. Is that, the horse was called Gem. Did your mother enter Gem and you? Yes, I suppose she did. Yeah, I'll take it.
Well tried, Sheila.
Repetition of horse.
Sorry, Sheila, incorrect challenge. So Clement gets another point for that, and there are 36 seconds on Gemini, Clement, starting now.
The lead classes, as well as the bending races, were possibly the most famous events which we conquered.
Derek Nimmo.
Events. Enter me for all sorts of events, most famous of events.
Derek, you have a point, and you have 29 seconds on Gemini, starting now.
The twins, an astrological sign, Castor and Pollux, spelt with a P. But in Egypt, of course, the sign was two kids, as opposed to two people. I meant that in sort of goat connotation.
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of two.
Yes, and Clement, you have 18 seconds now on Gemini, starting now.
I always remember the afternoon when Gem and I were taken to Norwich for treats. Tea, buns, cakes, sugar in the milkshake.
Sheila Hancock.
Did Jem really eat cakes and buns and things? Mm. This horse went into a tea shop and had
Jem and I, between us, we consumed all the things that I listed. And if you belt up, there were many other items as well.
Your mother, who'd obviously got this horse's interest at heart, entering it for all these events, wouldn't have permitted it to eat this all this junk.
Thank you very much, Peter. I was going to say exactly the same. So Sheila Hancock has a point, and there are 8 seconds on Gemini. Sheila, starting now.
If you are a Gemini, in other words, your sign is that, you usually have a split personality.
Peter Jones has challenged.
I was born on June the 12th, and I have not got a split personality.
You have.
Sheila, you have 1 second on Gemini, starting now.
Space module.
Sheila Hancock got some points in that round. She's moved ahead of Peter Jones in third place. And Peter Jones, it is your turn to begin. The subject is the sloppiest person I know. Would you talk about that for just a minute, if you can, starting now?
I'm not going to say who it is, but he would really prefer to eat bacon and eggs with a spoon than get up and reach for a knife and fork. Now, it's someone quite close to me from time to time, and I'm not going to say who it is.
Clement Freud's challenge.
Repetition of not going to say who it is.
Oh, that's right, yes. You're
making a great point of not saying that, Peter. And you lost the subject, and Clement Freud got in and gained a point, and there are 43 seconds. The sloppiest person I know, Clement, starting now.
I, too, am not going to say who the sloppiest person I know is, but the second sloppiest person, without much doubt, is Nicholas Parsons, who eats margarine where...
Hesitation, I'm afraid so. The audience inhibited you, but
they did
very well.
I wonder.
They're a nice, appreciative lot. There are 31 seconds for you, Derek, on the sloppiest person I know, starting now.
I was walking down the Royal Mile in Edinburgh, and there I met, for the first time, the sloppiest person I know. Garde-loo, he shouted, as he chucked from the third story a large chamber pot and its contents all over me. The pot shattered on the floor.
Sheila Hancock has challenged.
Repetition of pot.
Yes, there was too much potty there, I'm sorry. Derek, Sheila got in, and there are 13 seconds, Sheila, on the sloppiest person I know, starting now.
I have to confess that the sloppiest person I know is probably myself. I'm one of the few people that couldn't live in a caravan because, in fact, I found myself unable.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Well, repetition of myself and...
Yes, she kept going. She didn't hesitate, but she repeated. So, I'm sorry, you know, nicely speaking. There are 3 seconds on the sloppiest person I know, Derek. Start.
And in Holyrood Palace, I said, "What ho, MacTaggart, you rarely are the mucky pup."
Derek Nimmo got a number more points in that round. He's increased his lead at the end of the round. And Sheila Hancock begins the next round. The subject is friends I don't like. Sheila, will you go on that subject for 60 seconds if you can, starting now?
Friends I don't like seems to me a contradiction in terms, because they would not surely be your friends if you didn't like them. However, I will endeavour, as I have to speak for 5 seconds, 50, 60 seconds on the subject.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of seconds.
Far too many seconds. Yes, Sheila, you can't correct yourself in this game. So there are 45 seconds on whoever challenged, and I think it was Derek, wasn't it? Mm. Starting now.
François Dupont is one of the chums or amis that I don't care for terribly. I met him in St. Paul de Vence, which is in the loveliest part of that fair country from which so many of the audience tonight hail!
Sheila Hancock has challenged.
That's a hesitation, wasn't it?
Oh, definitely, yes. He hailed them all, and somebody needed the Nazi salute. there are 30 seconds on Friends I Don't Like, Sheila, with you now starting.
The friends I don't like are the ones who try to be honest with me. You know the sort I mean. They come up to you and they say, "Listen, I am your friend and I feel I ought to tell you, because people are mentioning it, that such and such is true."
Oh dear, Clement Freud.
Repetition.
Oh, yes.
Such and such is true, and Clement got in first, and there are 14 seconds. Clement, friends I don't like, starting now.
Friends I don't like is the sort of phrase which I deplore, because friends, which is another name for Quakers, are among the most decent and honourable people in this country. And for someone to come out with a statement...
Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin. The subject, a word we use a great deal in this programme, seconds. Can you talk on that for 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
Take 15 paces to the left, 25 to the right, ditto. I said, he said, somebody said.
Sheila Hancock challenge.
Repetition of sex.
Yes, of course. And there are 51 seconds
yes,
now
I for you to even talk. Matched, you see. I thought that was rather unfair for one to go 25 paces and then have to go 15 paces. I was rather mean. So I tried to correct it and move one back 5 paces and shove the other out another 5. I'm trying to be sportsmanlike about it, but you didn't let me go on. It's your own fault. You're the loser.
Yeah,
so sucks to you, and I don't mind. I won't say anymore. I mean, you know. Let's go by. That's what I can say.
Sheila, your challenge was correct quite a time ago before Derek got the bit between his teeth. And you have now 51 seconds to talk on the subject of seconds, starting now.
There are, in fact, 60 seconds in a minute. And in this programme, you have to keep talking for that length of time. And believe me, it is incredibly difficult, as I am giving ample proof of today. You also call your suite seconds, or at least my little girl does when she's at school, and sometimes it's jam pudding or rice the same, even macaroni or tart. I like that, personally.
Clement Freud challenge.
Oh, hesitation. God.
Hesitation? Yeah, I think she almost packed in, actually.
Grinding to
Clement, you have a correct challenge, and you have 17 seconds on seconds starting now.
Not very long ago, I went into a china shop and bought a cup and a saucer. And when I rouched home, they said it was broken.
Sheila Hancock is
challenged. When he rouched home?
Yes.
Sheila, I agree with your challenge, and you have 10.5 seconds on the subject of seconds starting now.
The people that are in attendance.
Clement Freud is challenged.
Repetition of people, I'm afraid.
Yes, you did say people before.
Did
I'm
I?
Afraid, yes. And Clement, you have 9 seconds on seconds starting now.
The extraordinary thing about purchasing crockery, which turns out to be broken, is that it's named seconds, meaning not first, and definitely...
P. Jones, it's your turn to begin, and the subject that Ian Messer's thought of is shocking people. So will you talk on that subject, if you can, for 60 seconds, starting now?
Well, my experience has been that people are not usually as shocked as others believe them to be. It is a fallacy that people make remarks, and I've repeated people already, you see, so I know I can't.
What is that? He said he has, but it's on the card.
I know, so it's an incorrect challenge.
Oh,
oh, is that right?
Yes, so you have another
but
point.
But he hesitated.
It's too late. Your first challenge was people, and people's on the card, and you can repeat the words on the card more than once or even twice. And, Peter, you continue. There are 47 seconds left. Shocking people, starting now.
This shook them, they say. Or there was a tremendous hush fell over the audience, and actually nothing of the kind happened. The people were not shaken, and a hush didn't fall over the audience. Never do
he
it.
He did repeat the falling hush, didn't
the
he?
The hush and the people and the audience and...
Yes.
You got interrupted, you couldn't get going again, Peter. Bad luck. 35 seconds, Sheila, for you now on shocking people, starting now.
In this day and age, it becomes increasingly difficult to shock people. When Bernard Shaw wrote Pygmalion, he managed that by just using the word bloody. But now we are so used to it, we don't turn a hair, except from a lady from Luton who always writes to me when I use it, and I doubtless will get one from her today.
Clement Freud has shot.
Hesitation.
Yes, it was.
Yes, yes, I thought you were going to say you should get a letter from her today. She can't possibly. The lady hasn't written the letter yet.
No.
Clement, there are 14 seconds on shocking people starting now.
I think the most shocking people I know are the ones who come to audiences in the Playhouse Theatre and never applaud, even if I win, only waiting for...
Peter Jones has challenged. You're right, Clement. You see, they're applauding Peter Jones's challenge now. What is it, Peter?
I don't think it's right. You can't alienate the audience, even if they're aliens. I mean, you shouldn't do that. It's,
but I'm afraid, Peter, he didn't alienate the audience. They all immediately clapped as soon as he said it. He endeared himself to the audience.
Well, I don't know quite who they were clapping, really.
I think he didn't. What is your challenge?
I'm not too sure now. I just felt instinctively there was something wrong in rounding on the audience in that way. I don't think you could do that, you know.
Yeah, well, all right. Give Peter Jones a point. Leave the subject with Clement Freud, and he has 4 seconds left. Shocking people, starting now.
Go up to any sensitive crowd and unbutton your shirt.
At the end of that round, Clement Freud took the lead, and Peter Jones is creeping up. And Sheila Hancock, your turn to begin. The subject, my destiny. Can you talk on that subject for just a minute, starting now?
I had some tarot cards read of mine the other day, and I was amazed. My life seems to have taken a turn for the better, and things like a new house and baby are going to happen, which indeed they are. The man was quite right. Other things he said were, like, I am going
Peter Jones has challenged.
Things.
I agree, Peter.
Things.
Repetition, and you have the subject now.
It wasn't very inspired.
I was going to say. You could have got your money back.
It was for charity.
What, the baby? Peter, you have 37 seconds on my destiny starting now.
Well, I've never actually had my hand read or sat in a tent with a gypsy and a crystal ball, so I really have no idea what the future has in store for me, and by that I mean my destiny. Of course, I have from time to time felt...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of time.
Yes, I'm afraid there was. And Clement, you have 20 seconds on my destiny starting now.
I have on occasion been to fortune tellers, clairvoyants, and even a gypsy in a tent who had a crystal ball which was terribly painful. And the day after I had been to that marquee and heard the full details of what would happen to me and my family, children, animals, pets...
Well, Clement Freud, speaking them in the whistle, ain't got an extra point. He's increased his lead at the end of that round. And Derek Nimmo, it's your turn to begin. The subject is the hole in my sock. Can you talk on that delightful subject for just a minute, starting now?
Well, it's been there quite a long time now. I got it last Tuesday. Actually, it's a curious thing. I was climbing Snowdon, a mountain in Wales you might perhaps have heard of, and I stumbled over this rock, and a very odd thing happened. You see, I went backwards, as it so turned out, and then I saw on this crag a piece of sheep's wool that was caught by a kind of, how would one describe it? I think barbed wire would be as good a way as any. Yes, I'll settle for... I thought I heard a buzz. I'm so sorry.
No, you didn't hear a buzz, but when you paused, there was a buzz.
Oh, well, I'm so sorry. I thought I heard a buzz. I didn't. I'm hearing bells and Joan of Arc.
Sheila, you buzzed, and your buzz
was...
Well,
he hesitated.
He did indeed. A very definite hesitation. So, Sheila, you have 35 seconds for the hole in my sock starting now.
The hole in my sock, in fact, is an entire one because I'm not wearing any. However, at home, I have a drawer full because I have a very long, big toe.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition have.
Yes, there was, Derek, and you have now 25 seconds to continue on the subject of the hole in my sock starting now.
So I sent for the Boy Scouts and the rescue and the nurses and the women's auxiliary service. I said, darn away, please. But, you know, they didn't have the wherewithal with them.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, Peter, I agree, and you have now 13 and a half seconds to continue on the subject of the hole in my sock starting now.
It's been there for a very long time. Only one single little garment. Hanging on the chandelier.
Derek Nimmo, challenge. No, I don't think it was hesitation. He searched for the chandelier and only just found it in time. Peter, you have now 6 seconds to continue on the hole in my sock starting now.
As a constant reminder to my wife and children that this does need repair, and I am unable...
I'm afraid we have no more time to play just a minute, alas. But let me tell you what happened. Peter Jones came at the end with a flourish, but he still finished in fourth place, I'm sorry to say. He couldn't quite catch up Derek Nimmo, who finished alongside Sheila Hancock in second place. And she was three behind this week's winner, once again, Clement Freud. Popular win. We did not alienate his audience. We hope you've enjoyed listening to Just a Minute. From all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The program was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch.
present Kenneth Williams, Clement Freud, Peter Jones and Alfred Marx in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Hello and welcome to Just a Minute. And we're delighted to welcome back Alfred Marx to play the game with our three regular competitors. And as usual, I'm going to ask them to speak, if they can, for just a minute on some unlikely subject without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject which is on the card in front of me. And we will begin the show this week with Alfred Marx. Alfred, we would like you to start the show by talking about what I learn from this show. So can you talk on that subject for 60 seconds, starting now?
I am the occasional member of this panel. I have been asked quite a few times to come here, and it's always a pleasure. So I have learned a great deal from this show. One of the things I have learned, or several things I have learned from this show, have been how charming the rest of the panel are, and also the chairman and Mr. Messiter. For example, we have Kenneth, who, the marvelous comedian, never lost for a smile, a line in the right place. And we have Clement Freud, urbane, erudite, Peter Jones, who's sitting next to me, a wonderful companion. One thing I have learned is, because I am the new boy, they're very kind. And the rules...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Thing three times.
Yes.
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 And he's learned one other thing. They're not very kind.
No. No.
Clement.
All except Clement Freud.
Clement, you have a correct challenge, so you get a point for that, of course. And you take over the subject of what I learn from this show, and there are 26 seconds left, starting now.
To put it succinctly in my urbane, eclectic way, is hardly anything at all. I've been on this show since it first began, and I think...
Alfred Marx has challenged.
I think it's a deviation, because obviously, by what he just said, he has learned nothing from this show at all.
Well, that's what he was saying.
He's just as nasty and as rude as he always has been. And therefore, he's deviating from the question, which is what I've learned from this show. The answer is nothing.
Well, that's just what he was saying, Alfred.
I see. All right.
So he wasn't.
See how easily pleased I am?
So that's an incorrect challenge, and Clement gets a point for that. Keeps the subject. 15 seconds left, starting now.
I have learnt that if you go down Golders Green Underground Station and pay 27p, you may get out at Streatham and pay a small surcharge. I never knew about this before I started to do Just a Minute, when the producer met me in the tea bar.
I bet he knew about that long before he went on to Just a Minute. But Clement Freud was then speaking when the whistle went, which tells us that 60 seconds is up, so he gains an extra point for doing so, and at the end of that round, he's the only one to have any points at all. Kenneth Williams, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is spleen. Can you talk on that for just a minute, starting now?
It's a purplish-coloured organ to the left of the stomach and is responsible for mandrel facturing lymphocytes. These are transmitted round the body rather than the same way that Harvey discovered the blood circulation, and are very, very effective
and
in
Alfred
warding
Marks
off the odd germ.
Has challenged you.
What, who challenged?
Alfred Marx did.
Yes, most uncharitable.
Well, two, actually. One is a repetition of very.
Yeah.
And the other one is making me thoroughly ill.
Very, very is repetitious, and there are 35 seconds for you, Alfred, on spleen, starting now.
Also, the word spleen can be applied to someone who has a lot of spunk, guts, or courage. You have often heard someone say, "My word, what an amount of spleen that man really has."
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
It's completely incorrect. Spleen does not mean that. It means acidity and rudeness, and it doesn't mean pluck or courage at all. He's giving the audience a completely wrong impression. They're going to go out of here saying, "Oh, you got a load of spleen, dear," when they haven't
got...
Yes, what do you say?
May I ask you, which side did you say your spleen was on?
I didn't say mine.
No.
I said the spleen is situated to the left of the stomach.
Normally to the left. The people I refer to are those who have their spleen on the right. Those people are gutsy, courageous.
Alfred, I agree with Kenneth's challenge,
yes.
And you can't wriggle out of it that way.
No.
There are 24 seconds for you, Kenneth, on spleen, starting now.
Well, the spleen, of course, is not something you really can go on about,
Clement,
if you understand.
Clement Freud has challenged you.
Of course, again.
You did say, of course.
Oh, of course.
So
very
Clement
keen listener,
now has
isn't
another
he?
Point and 20 seconds on spleen, starting now.
Harris Tweed, lights and spleen are absolutely essential if you want to make haggis, which is normally consumed with a quantity of whiskey, either blended or single malt.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Harris, tweed isn't an ingredient of haggis.
No, it definitely
isn't. Certainly it tastes like it.
And sometimes even looks like it, but you wouldn't
I don't accept that.
No, but it's all right. You make your haggis your way, and we'll make ours our way. And Peter Jones,
I don't intend making it at all.
Well, you can have 9 seconds on which to talk about spleen, Peter, starting now.
I associate it with the gallbladder and the stones which are sometimes inside.
Kenneth Williams
has gallbladder has nothing to do with spleen, so it's deviation.
No, but I associate it.
We're not concerned with
because
what
you're
not
going
to mislead all these people. They're going to go out of here saying, how's your bladder next, aren't they?
No, I don't think they'll raise the subject of bladder.
No, and he was saying that he associated with it, so he wasn't actually deviating from the subject on the card, so he gets a point for that, and there are 2.5 seconds on spleen, Peter, starting now.
I've got several feet of this.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
You can't have several feet of spleen.
No, I hadn't got to, as far as saying intestines.
Well, that's nothing to do with spleen, therefore you're deviating from the subject.
So Kenneth has 1 second on which to talk about spleen, starting now.
It is the acidity which comes from this organ.
So at the end of that round, Kenneth Williams got the point for speaking when the whistle went, and he's now in second place, 1 point behind Clement Freud, Peter Jones in third, and Alfred in fourth, 1 point separating each one of them. Peter Jones, your turn to begin, and the subject is very apt after what's been happening, is waffle. So can you talk on waffle for just a minute, starting now?
I can remember vividly the very first waffle I ever ate. It was in the restaurant of a store in Liverpool. Lewis's, possibly the Bon Marché, I don't know, but it was...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
He can't remember vividly when he doesn't remember...
I remember the waffle vividly, you idiot.
I take it back. You're
it was
right
so right. Vivid, right. He lost all idea of where he was.
Yes.
And so he has 50 seconds to continue on waffle, starting now.
There were about 48 small squares in each of the two. And in...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
Well, then he doesn't remember it vividly if there were about 48 squares.
I was too young to count. I was only 8.
No, I think it's a very clever challenge, which will give him a point.
You think that's a clever challenge?
Yes.
Well, might as well pack it up and go home, you know. I mean,
40 seconds if you can continue on waffle, Clement, starting now.
One of the greatest bull points about having a beard is that you can waffle into it. You can say things...
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
Deviation. This game has nothing to do with bull points.
Bull points?
You say one of the greatest bull points.
You can write underwater with them, can't you?
No, he said bull points.
Oh, sorry, your diction didn't do good. I can't hear
too well. I don't even know what a bull
point is. Exactly, it's deviation.
Can you help us to understand what you said a bit more, Clement?
What a bull point is?
Yes.
I'm really not here to teach you
good,
words
then
which
Kenneth
you
Williams
don't
has a point, and there are 34 seconds on waffle with you, Kenneth, starting...
Well, to rise in the early morn with your waking thoughts of clarity in the Milo, and remember that very quickly the ancient Greece's sparkles where the wax or Ulysses stuff in the eardrome in order to pass the siren safely.
Alfred Marx has challenged.
Well, there's no doubt that's absolute rubbish, is it not?
It's also waffle.
Ah, yes, but you must talk about waffle. You must not waffle. Surely.
Well, I think you'll find it can be jolly difficult to keep it up for another 25 seconds, so we give him a point and he continues now, starting now.
Yes, well, I suppose it could be to speak in such a fashion that what you're imparting is totally unintelligible, but on the other hand, much fun can be had with the construction linguistically of certain syntactical errors and indeed the zeugma. He took his oath and his seat. And the split infinitive, he quickly...
Clement, your turn to begin. The subject is the trouble with most chairmen. Would you try and talk about it for 60 seconds, Clement, starting now?
The trouble with most chairmen is paling into insignificance compared to Nicholas Parsons, who doesn't know the difference between a spleen and a waffle, and has never heard the word bull point, which, of course, is
I can't repeat it.
Alfred Marx has challenged.
Well, I think a hesitation that you agree.
I think yes. So. Whatever you would have challenged for, I'd have given it to you. The, but no, he
That's
definitely
the
hesitated.
Most chairman, yes.
Yes, he definitely hesitated. And there are 44 seconds on the trouble with most chairmen, Alfred, starting now.
The trouble with most chairmen is they are not like you, if I may say so, Nicholas, in that you are fair, you impart your judgments with great clarity, also you take great pains not to offend people.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
Deviation is the most glaring sycophancy I've ever heard.
Right. You're absolutely right.
The challenge is wrong,
but he's right.
So what is your challenge?
Deviation.
Why? He's not deviating from the subject of the trouble of most chairman. He can be as sycophantic as he like keep going on the subject. So there are 32 seconds, Alfred, on the trouble of most chairman, starting now.
I'm as sycophantic as I'm of Kenneth. That has nothing at all to do with it. What I was saying is the trouble with most chairman is, unlike you, they go on and on giving points where they
Clement Freud has challenged.
And on.
And, Clement, you have another point and 23 seconds on the trouble with most chairmen, starting now.
The trouble with most chairmen is that when they speak at their annual general meeting and announce the results for the previous year, they invariably forget to forecast the business, the trends, and the bull points for the coming 12 months, which shareholders are desperately keen to hear about. Bondholders, stock...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, I agree, Peter. There are 4.5 seconds on the trouble with most chairmen starting now.
Well, they don't really try to get along with the team. Now...
And at the end of that round, Alfred is still in fourth place, Peter is in second place, and Clement Freud is in the lead with Kenneth Williams. Alfred, your turn to begin. The subject, promises. Can you talk on that for just a minute, starting now?
Somebody once said promises were made to be broken. I don't think it was Voltaire, and it certainly I do not believe was Racine either. However, I don't subscribe to this philosophy because there are promises and there are promises. For example, if my wife...
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
There are and there are.
Oh, there are. Yes, you're quite right.
You can repeat the word, the subject, which is promises, but not the other word.
Thank you so much. And I'm very grateful to Kenneth for buzzing me.
And getting a point in the process.
That's quite all right. Just wait till he starts.
43 seconds, Kenneth, on promises, starting now.
These, of course, are very often made when the person little knows what the future will hold in store, so to speak. The one that is made in the sacred vow, so to speak, of marriage.
Clement Freud's challenge.
So to speak.
Yes, you did say so to speak before, I'm afraid.
Well, I was nervous, you see.
Well, you don't need to be nervous in this game after the long time you've played it, Kenneth. 24 seconds on promises, Clement, starting now.
I think the very first promises I ever made were when I was in the Boy Scouts and I was on Hampstead Heath with a staff with which I ankle-tapped others in the peewit platoon in which I had been placed by a sympathetic master who went around wearing leather shirts and shorts of extraordinary length, his knees only just...
Amazing about the personal revelations you get in this game from time to time. But anyway, he kept Clement going, he spoke again when the whistle went, gained the extra point, and he's increased his lead at the end of that round. Kenneth Williams, we're back with you. Would you talk now on Girolamo Savonarola? It's a historical character which I'm sure Kenneth knows something about because Ian Nestor knows his interest and penchant for history. So would you start now?
Yes, well, he was at the time of Lorenzo de Medici and he came to the city and with this kind of zealous preaching, he was a great Puritan, he upset everyone so much that in the end the Medici family, I've said that twice, were forced to flee and...
And Alfred Marx has challenged.
Yes, he said it twice.
Yeah. You shouldn't have drawn their attention to it, Kenneth. Alfred, you have the subject. There are 44 seconds left on Girolamo Savonarola, starting now.
I do not have the erudition of Kenneth on history, but the Girolamo Savonarola I know happens to be a restaurateur in Soho. He specializes spaghetti Savonarola, which is a sort of a pasta made with tomatoes, cheese, eggs, sardines, and ham. This is a very special dish, and only idiots would eat it. I happen to be one of that ilk, as I go in there quite often, and I'm thoroughly ill each time. However, I have stopped going to this particular place because, really, I'm very fond of fish and chips. And as I do not know a fish and chip restaurant...
Clement Freud is challenged. Clement, I agree with the challenge. There are 10 seconds.
There were two portions, actually. You see, one for me and one for the wife.
Too late, and anyway, incorrect. 10 seconds, Clement, starting now.
I've never had a Savonarola car, and I don't believe that too many of them are on the market, whereas at most...
Despite of advertising outrageously, Clement kept going and again increased his lead at the end of the round. Peter Jones, we're back with you. Can you talk on the subject of the press for 60 seconds, starting now?
They've always been quite pleasant to me, but it does occur to me from time immemorial, really, that there's a...
It can't have occurred to Peter from time immemorial.
You haven't been here that long.
Thanks very much. So that challenge of his is correct. And, Kenneth, you have the subject 52 seconds on the press, starting now.
They are, on the whole, a pretty fair bunch of people. With actors and interviews, they tend rather to cut up what one has said, and it becomes an edited process. And you don't think after, oh, what I said, I really speak like that. Of course these things can be made, you know what I mean, blown up into embarrassing proportions, the microcosm of life, so to speak, the theatre, all the world's a stage, and all the men and women, merely players, they have their exits and their entries. One man, in his time, plays many parts.
Someone? And you've been challenged by Peter Jones.
What happened?
Yeah, just give us your...
All, he repeated all.
That was A-W-L, you great fool.
No, all the world's a stage and all the men and women.
No, I meant my all, you see. But they do the nails.
Then you'll be devious.
Shakespeare
incorrectly.
That's true, I often do.
Yes, well, there are 25 seconds for Peter to continue on the press, starting now.
Whose private life could really bear that kind of examination? I wonder...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Mine could.
That was a rhetorical question.
I gave you a rhetorical answer.
But it was not a correct challenge, so he has 13 seconds to continue with the press, Peter, starting now.
It is, Clement will agree, an open invitation on his part to the press to investigate his personal life. I am of a different opinion.
Too late.
I think, perhaps... that it may uncover...
Alfred Marx's challenge.
Oh, I think a hesitation.
Alfred Marx, you have a correct challenge, and you have 1 second left on the press, starting now.
Someone once said...
At the end of that round, Alfred Marx gained an extra point for speaking when the whistle went. He's still in fourth place behind our leader, Clement Freud. And, Clement, your turn to begin the subject, cooling it. Can you talk on that for just a minute, starting now?
Cooling it is one of those new phrases like heavy man. And I've never properly understood when someone said cool it, whether it meant putting a lump of ice into their drink or doing up your trousers.
Challenge.
I thought a hesitation there.
You thought correctly, and there are 45 seconds for cooling it with you, Kenneth, starting now.
Well, cooling it, as far as I'm concerned, simply does mean chilling the delicious wine, preferably Frascati, something from the country of Romeo and Juliet. And as they cool it, you see the bubbles glistening on the side of the bottle, and one's taste buds start to work overtime, and the adrenaline goes flowing round the body, and I echo, cooling it! Yes, that's what I'm after!
Would do the job just as well.
Kenneth Williams kept going magnificently on cooling it, including speaking when the whistle went, gaining the extra point, and once again, he's moved into the lead alongside Clement Freud. And Alfred Marx, your turn to begin on the subject, marksmanship. That's a good subject for you, so would you talk on it, Alfred, starting now?
I consider this is a rather private joke on the part of Mr. Ian Mest, who thought, aha, we have Alfred Marx on the show. Why not give him the subject marksmanship? I've heard of one-upmanship, upon which I could speak, gamesmanship, ditto, but marksmanship proves rather difficult for me. I'm sitting here praying and pleading that someone will now press the button so that I may be devious and wait till the last couple of seconds.
Kenneth Williams has challenged you.
Yeah, well, he asked for someone to come in, so I'll come in for it.
Because you think he's being devious, and you are correct, and you have 37 seconds on marksmanship starting now.
The first time this test was undergone by myself was on the rifle range when I had to fire a Lee Enfield rifle. I went all over the place, nothing hit the target, and the sergeant said, "You can make the tee, mate." And I...
when I... Clement Freud is challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
Sergeants don't call soldiers mate.
You don't know this particular sergeant, do you? And for all we know, he might have referred to Kenneth as mate. In fact, he might have been his mate.
Yes, he was. He gave me his photo. I've got it. I've got it in my album.
Kenneth, you have an incorrect challenge, so you get a point for that. You have 23 seconds to continue on marksmanship starting now.
The only reason I am continuing on marksmanship is so that Alfred may come in at that last minute with some wonderful piece of advice to you all on this subject and thus score. But obviously he's not going to do it. I can see his hand lingering on his button.
He's done it! Alfred.
Deviation, I have every intention of doing it. How can he possibly know I don't want to do it?
All right, Alfred, you have 9 seconds on marksmanship starting now.
Now I know the subject of marksmanship, I will now continue to expound on the said one, because, you see, there are various targets which can come under the subject.
Alfred Marks was then speaking when the whistle went, so he gained the extra point. He's moved into third place, but Kenneth Williams is now in a strong lead. And Peter Jones, will you begin the next round? How I got done on my holiday. 60 seconds, starting now.
Well, I just took my clothes off and laid down on a towel on the beach. I applied a bit of oil.
Alfred Marks has challenged.
Oh, I think a hesitation.
Yes, he lay down on the beach and he's gone, wasn't he?
Yeah.
There are 51 seconds on how I got done on the beach. No, how I got done on my holiday. Uh, 51 seconds, Alfred, starting now.
Work did not allow me to spend my holiday with my family, and consequently, I had to go away on my...
Kenneth Williams is challenged.
Hesitation. Constantly.
A very sharp one, but we give it to you,
Kenneth.
You've
got to be very, very sharp in this case.
Yes.
45 seconds on how I got done on my holiday, Kenneth, starting now.
They said it was a direct flight to Tangier. Well, halfway, he said the engine's gone, and we were shoved down in this place called Bordeaux. I was the cynosure in the transit room of all eyes. And this fella come up, he'd had a few, mind you. Oh, yeah, ain't you the one on the telly? I said, well, yes, that does happen to be my forte. And, of course, I was what you might call,
Alfred Marks is challenged.
That was a hesitation
if I'd ever heard one. Yeah. There are 20 seconds for Alfred Marks to continue now on how I got done on my holiday starting now.
So I went into the travel agent and I said, I must go on my holiday alone this year. I don't relish that idea at all. And he said to me, well, we have a gentleman here who, like you, also is having to have a holiday completely alone. And so I said, I wouldn't mind.
Peter Jones has challenged.
A repetition of alone.
Yes. And I said, six seconds, Peter, on how I got done on my holiday, starting now.
I went down to the wine country of France, and there I went into an airfield.
Oh, Clement Freud challenge, actually, just before the whistle, I was told.
I went down, I went in, two wents.
Clement Freud, you have half a second on how I got done on my holiday, starting now.
Went.
Well, Clement Freud cleverly got in just before the whistle, and as we have no more time to play the game, I can tell you that he nearly achieved it, but not quite. The final score was that Peter Jones was just in fourth place. He got a lot of points, but he was 1 point behind Alfred Marks. Alfred Marks was 2 points behind Clement Freud, but Clement, in spite of the last challenge, still finished up 1 point behind this week's winner, Kenneth Williams. A popular and well-deserved win. We hope you enjoyed listening to the show. From all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The program was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by John Lloyd.
Thank you. present Kenneth Williams, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones and Andre Melly in just a minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Hello and welcome to Just a Minute. And once again, I'm going to ask our four contestants to speak, if they can, on some subject that I will give them without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject on the card, if they can. And we'll start the program this week with Derek Nimmo. The subject is bill stickers. You have 60 seconds, starting now.
My son Timothy has a friend called Sarah Kay, who spent most of her childhood looking at notices saying bill stickers will be prosecuted. And she always wondered what bill stickers had done that the law was continually after him for. And I can understand that. I do hate people who go around with this fly posting, bill sticking all over the place. I think this commercial graffiti, and I use that word advisedly, ought to be torn down. One sees the countryside sullied, the towns destroyed, everything covered and marked in bits of tatty paper, advertising all sorts of trips that you don't really want to go on. All wonderful things that are unobtainable because these bill stickers are at work, and you go down any street, any yard, any road in this kingdom ruled by our gracious sovereign, and you will see bill stickers at once. Why don't you stop? Why don't you go out to this theater tonight, all of you, sitting there like a lot of lazy slugs, and tell...
You have actually been challenged at last by Peter Jones.
He said, why don't you, twice.
I agree with your challenge. You get a point for that, and therefore you take over the subject, and there are 9 seconds left for you to continue on bill stickers, starting now.
Well, some of them are pirates. They don't pay rent for the accommodation and the space which is used by these quite ordinary advertisements.
At the end of 60 seconds, Ian Messiter blows his whistle. It tells us that 60 seconds is up, and whoever is speaking at that moment gets an extra point. It was, on this occasion, Peter Jones. So, Peter, you have a lead over everybody at the end of that round.
Hello.
Andree, will you begin the next round? I love
this
subject.
Yes, I'd love to. I'd just like to say I'm here. Hello.
Hello, Andree.
Hello, Andree.
Hello.
You're beginning the next round, so you can say more than hello.
Yes, well, I'll try.
The subject is porridge. Will you talk for just a minute, if you can, on that subject, starting now?
Well, porridge, like so many things in life, is delicious when it's hot and absolutely revolting when cold. I love it in the winter with lots of sugar and cream, frightfully fattening but scrumptious, to go to school in the morning, muffled up, having had a good dose of porridge.
Derek Nimmo, chap.
I can't believe she's still at school.
I don't think she is still at school, but she was making the point that it was nice to be muffled up going to school on a good bowl of hot porridge.
Yeah,
so
I
disagree with your challenge. Andree gets a point for that. She keeps the subject, and there are 43 seconds left, starting now.
It's also a word used for doing a term in prison, which seems to me absolutely extraordinary. I don't know the deviation of it, but isn't English fascinating?
Kenneth Williams,
I don't know the deviation of it.
I think she meant derivation.
She meant derivation.
Yes,
did she?
I think she.
I see. This is all being conveyed to a vast audience. I don't know the deviation of it. I just wondered whether my ears had deceived me,
Kenneth,
or what was happening.
Kenneth,
She's going to school, the next minute she's wondering where it deviates.
Well, that's why she needs to go to school on a bowl of hot porridge, because... But anyway, when you're keeping going under pressure, it can easily slip up like that. But it was a correct challenge.
Likely story.
Kenneth. Can you pull yourself together for a moment? It was a correct challenge, so you have the subject. And there are 34 seconds starting now.
Well, it's just a minute, you know, where you have to keep going on
the same
subject.
I've got the subject here. Made from Scotch oats, and you put it in this pan and boil it all up with this milk. I mean, it can come out very lumpy indeed. And most of the time, I think civilized people agree this is the sort of rubbish that's only eaten by peasantry, or certainly...
Andree Melly has challenged.
On behalf of the Scottish landladies to whom I am devoted, I should like to object to that very biased attack about Scots porridge.
I see. You would like to object, would you?
Yes, I would.
Think Dr. Johnson said you feed them oats in Scotland. He said you only feed a horse that in England.
All one can say in reply to that, but look what a fine race the Scots are.
Yes, all right, I suppose. I'm Welsh myself.
So I think everybody of all classes eats porridge, and they're better for it if they enjoy it.
Yes.
14 seconds on porridge with you, Andree, starting now.
If you look...
Kenneth Williams, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes. Kenneth, you have 13 seconds on porridge starting now.
I believe it's done in a snood, and in Cold Comfort Flam, Flora Post does advise...
Andree Melly has challenged.
It sounded to me like Cold Comfort Flam.
Well, it was Cold Comfort Farm, so
did
I think
you hear
it was.
Flam?
There was no L. I didn't say flam. I speak much better than you. My diction's superb.
Oh, stop getting pedantic, all of you. Kenneth,
what was that you said?
You have a point for a wrong challenge, and you have 7 seconds on porridge starting now.
A dollop of the porridge has gone into the fire, she cried. Oh, what a hiss it's made, and a nasty stain.
Kenneth Williams was then speaking when the whistle went, and he got 4 points in that round, and he now has a commanding lead over everybody else.
Done. How wonderful.
And something that might be stimulated by porridge is the next subject, phagocytes. Kenneth, we'd like you to take the subject. Would you talk about the phagocytes or just phagocytes? Just a minute, starting now.
These are the protoplasmic organisms on the leukocyte side of the actual white corpuscles. These energy remain.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Unaccountably stopped. Hesitation, I know.
You mustn't be so sensitive, Kenneth, because...
I know, I'm terribly sensitive.
You suddenly think that somebody's about to do something. We're not. We're all encouraging you. And actually, you dried
Except
up there.
Except Nimmo, he isn't.
No, you're right about that. Derek, you have a point for a correct challenge, and there are 37 seconds on phagocytes starting now.
Indeed, a phagocyte is a leukocyte, which means that it's transparent and you can see through it. It is derived from a Latin word, which I won't give you because I shall be told that I'm showing off, as people sometimes say. I will abandon it, and it's very important to the...
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
I wouldn't accuse you of showing off. I'd love to know.
That's it. So in that case, you get a point because it was deviating. That's, and there are 25 right, yeah, seconds on phagocytes with you, Kenneth, starting now.
Well, these are the microorganisms in the human body which fight immediately any infection enters.
Derek Nimmo,
Repetition of microorganisms.
Yes, you did say that. So Derek's got a point, and there are 19 seconds on phagocytes starting now.
I often wander down the street and see an old biddy game pass, and I shut up, you old phagocyte, I say. And surprising the result it has, because they don't know what
it's a challenge.
Deviation. He has never done that in his life. He never shouted to a lady. I'm
sure he's never done that, Kenneth. So I give you a point for that challenge. And you have 12 seconds on phagocytes starting now.
They rush to the aid of the nutriment and healing process that goes on within the human body. They come to
Derek
the brain.
Nimmo challenged.
Repetition of human body.
You did mention the human body before, I'm afraid. There are 3 seconds for you, Derek, on phagocytes starting now.
They are, of course...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Hesitation, definitely hesitation.
Very slow starting.
I didn't even think it out. I've got no idea,
has
he?
Oh, no.
I don't think he hesitated, actually. He did repeat they are.
Well, what did he do? Why did
he repeated they are, but you didn't challenge him for that.
No, he didn't start for a long time.
He did start.
We were hanging about, going from one foot to the other, waiting for him to start, weren't we?
Well, you must move very quickly within the half second.
Well, I do, and so would you if you were sitting next to Kenneth Williams.
Peter Jones, a point for the best remark he's made for the whole evening. The subject with Derek Nimmo, and a point also for Derek, because it was an incorrect challenge. Phagocytes, Derek, starting now.
Phagocytes is a very difficult word, and a lot of people don't quite...
At the end of that round, Derek, speaking with the whistle, got the extra point. Derek, in spite of getting a lot of points that round, still hasn't caught up on Kenneth Williams, who's 1 point ahead of him and still in the lead. And Peter Jones and Andree Melly are trailing a little way behind. But Peter, it's your turn to begin. The subject is making your own radio set. Can you talk for just a minute on that subject, starting now?
Well, it's not nearly as fascinating as it used to be now that they've introduced the printed circuit. When I was a boy, I used to go and buy a bit at a time, a condenser here, a transformer there, valves and coils and bits of wire and things of...
Andree Melly.
No hesitation there.
I think so, Andree, yes. 42 seconds on making your own radio set, Andree, starting now.
If your own radio set is kind of falling about, the best thing to do is put it on a plate, pour some gelatine over it and put it in the fridge. If it doesn't set, you have to start all over again. Place it in a saucepan, have the light going under it, shove it around a bit, jiggle it up and down, and then sort the things out afterwards in whatever order you think, because radios being the way they are, they could work or not according to how they feel, according to how they feel. Judge.
A load of rubbish, isn't it? Radio sets in jelly and then putting them in the fridge. She patently doesn't know how to make a radio set.
Right.
Let alone how to mend
making,
one.
You see, one could interpret it by making your own radio set. It could be Andre's radio set, which would be utterly useless afterwards.
Yes.
But I think, actually, Derek, to be fair, we must give it to you.
I don't see why you should. There's a woman who's given testament that she boils her clocks every year. And she's given testament to this fact, and every one of her clocks keeps jolly good time, and she boils them regular. So why shouldn't she pour jelly over her radio?
But then shaking it up and jiggling it about and putting it in the oven and the fridge and boiling it out,
well,
I don't think you make a very
about
good radio.
It's nice. You do the okey-cokey and you turn around. Very nice. I thought she was giving us all a bit of invigoration, a bit of life, and he comes down like a ton of bricks. No gallantry at all for ladies. You've got no gallantry.
No,
you have a woman on the show, you should defer to her. Give her a little bit of courtesy. Encouragement.
I thought it was very nice, but I agree with Derek's challenge. 15 seconds, Derek, making your own radio set starting now.
Making your own radio set is much easier, Dave, because there's so many second-hand parts that you can buy down, say, Tottenham Court Road or even Charing Cross Road. You can buy these things.
Andree Melly.
Two roads.
Yes, there were, Andree. 4 seconds, making your own radio set starting now.
Do it yourself. That's what we can all manage these days.
Andree Melly got a large number of points that round. She's moved forward rapidly. She's 1 point behind Derek Nimmo, who's now equal in the lead with Kenneth Williams. And Derek, your turn to begin. The subject, getting rid of wasps' nests. Can you talk about that for 60 seconds, starting now?
I think it's a great pity to get rid of wasps' nests. They're singularly inoffensive creatures. If you don't attack them, they won't go for you. And this is really something which people don't realise. People are so often rushing...
Peter Jones.
Repetition of people.
Yes, I'm afraid so, Derek. And Peter, a correct challenge to you in 47 seconds on getting rid of wasps' nests starting now.
Well, I don't go along with the idea that if you treat a wasp nicely, you can make it into a pet. I think they are rather unpleasant and dangerous. And certainly when there is a nest of them, it has to be eliminated from one's dwelling place or garden, because it is a potential danger to children and guests apart from one's immediate family. Get on to your local council and someone will come along in a small van and get rid of them for you, together with any mice or other insects you find, apart from the wasps that we are really trying to get rid of ourselves. Now, paraffin set alight is a dangerous thing to use. I wouldn't recommend it. Ferris dust, I don't think, does anything. They probably eat it.
Well, Peter Jones got a lot of points in that round, so it's an interesting situation. He's moved forward now to be equal in second place with Andree Melly, but they're both 1 point behind Kenneth Williams and Derek Nimmo in the lead. Andree Melly, your turn to begin. The subject, the International Dateline. Would you talk on that for just a minute, if you can, starting now?
The International Dateline used to go something like this. Excuse me, mademoiselle, forgive me for talking to you, but haven't we met somewhere before? And the answer was, gracias, oui, monsieur, où est la dolce vita? They're ever so nice. But now, with the package holidays up the spout, the only kind of international dates most of us will be seeing next year come in a box with one of those sticky little forks, because I expect we'll be on the end of Blackpool Pier. I used to love those international datelines, but I didn't do awfully well because I was too thin for
Derek
the
Nimmo, challenge
of love.
Yes, that's right, yes. There are 20 seconds with you, Derek, on the international dateline starting now.
Something I've never really quite been able to understand. I know that sometimes when I'm flying to, say, Australia, I lose a whole day. And people never really been able to explain it to me. Suddenly, it's Wednesday instead of Tuesday. Monday has totally disappear without trace. Or should it be the other way around? It probably might be, yes. But then one looks at a calendar.
Derek was again speaking when the whistle went. He's increased his lead at the end of the round. And Kenneth Williams, we're back with you. The subject, the Iliad. Can you talk to us about that for just a minute, starting now?
Well, it's this great epic poem by Homer. I believe there are 24 books altogether telling of the wrath of Achilles and the death of Patroclus. Of course, it's derived from Ilion, which is, you know, the Greek for Troy. It is a masterpiece and, I suppose, has provided the pattern model for all the works of art that would come within that genre thereafter. I myself have been very moved, this wonderful vision, the face, he says, that launched a thousand ships, this impenetrable, illegible description of Helen, and of course the husband who was Menelaus, and the bloke she went off with being Paris. And apparently they had an illicit affair, and the
Just wake up. Derek, you challenged.
Well, I could hear this time.
Yeah,
it's really difficult. I thought he said and quickly together.
I couldn't hear a word he was saying.
I thought your clock had stopped for a while. It seemed to be going on for such a long time.
I think you'd better complete the subject, Kenneth. There are 5 seconds left on the Iliad starting now.
Well, you get rid of wasps by lowering a boy covered in treacle into the nest, and you will find that the wasp will stick to him and he'll come straight out again.
Andree, very
deviation and repetition all in one.
How do you know they didn't have any wasp nests in the Iliad when the Odyssey was going on? I think it was a grossly inaccurate challenge.
Oh.
You have 2 seconds on the Iliad wasp's nest starting now.
There's the ancient craggy Ithaca with Ulysses or the stubby Iliad road in all its far country.
It was one of those occasions when I really wasn't fit to judge, as it was obvious. And Kenneth got
there
the extra
many
point.
Occasions like that.
Peter Jones, your turn to begin. The subject, the great nebula in Andromeda.
What? Say that again, Nick.
Well, I'll do my best.
What is it?
The great nebula in Andromeda.
Oh, and you're going to give him that?
Yes.
Oh, what's that? Well, I don't very posh this game, isn't it?
After the Iliad and wasps' nests, we have the great nebula in Andromeda, and we're going to ask Peter Jones to talk about it for 60 seconds, if he can, starting now.
Well, it's a great bit of luck getting this subject, because by an extraordinary coincidence, I was browsing through an encyclopedia only the other day, it may have been a fortnight ago, and I was looking for a good recipe for porridge or instructions on how to make your own radio set or something of that kind, and I came across this article written by a well-known authority on the very thing that they want me to talk about. And another extraordinary event occurred.
Derek Nimmo,
extraordinary.
Oh, leave him. He was just getting going.
Started, hadn't started yet.
Is there no decent manners at all?
Did I say extraordinary before?
No, of course you didn't.
Well, I wasn't listening to myself because I thought it was rather boring.
Yes,
I'm
did,
afraid you did say extraordinary before.
Oh, I did.
Peter,
what our
well, what does it matter? Well. Why don't you throw precedent to the winds, Nick? Why don't you give yourself a breath of fresh air?
Derek, you have a correct challenge. You have 29 seconds on the great nebula in Andromeda starting now.
What people don't realize about Andromeda's great nebula is, in fact, that it is really a wasp nest. And the thing that one ought to do is get some Paris powder.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
This is a hopeless deviation. I mean,
what about you and the Iliad a moment
ago? Well, tell
us
what it is then. Tell us what it is.
The nebula.
What is the nebula in the great nebula in Andromeda?
The nebula in the Andromeda. Well,
what is it? Come on, what is it? Well, if you can tell us what it is, I'll give you the.
Ah,
the
well, I don't know what it is.
Your challenge. Well, it's going to be good fun. It's going to be good fun. Your challenge because he's deviating because he was in.
Because I know jolly well it's nothing to do with the wasp. This, right. And so do you, you great nit. How dare you?
I quite agree. So, Kenneth, you have a point for a correct challenge.
Thank you.
You have 22 seconds to talk about the Great Nebula in Andromeda, starting now.
Well, I mean, the Great Nebula in Andromeda is something I really am not awfully,
He obviously, he's admitted that he doesn't know anything about it, and he's making, you know, drowning gestures to me, hoping that I'm
so
going to interrupt.
So why are you challenging, then?
Well, sheer compassion.
Why don't you challenge for hesitation?
All right, hesitation.
Well done. There are 15 seconds for you, Peter, on the Great Nebula in Andromeda, starting now.
Yes, well, you see, this diagram riveted my attention, and the small print, which went on for about 8 pages. I was up most of the night on that particular...
Andree Melly.
I thought he hesitated there.
Yes, I think he did. And there are 4.5 seconds for Andree on the Great Nebula in Andromeda, starting now.
I was browsing through an encyclopedia and happened not to come across this particular subject.
What is it?
There's nobody...
We can't just leave it at that. What is it?
All right, give me a chance, you two. Quick! For those though, who maybe don't know what it is, it's a galaxy of stars.
I see.
Yes.
Sounds sort of nebulous, doesn't it? A great nebula. Loads of old rubbish.
Well, not to an astrologer.
No, I suppose not.
The end of that round, very interesting situation. Very close, Peter Jones, only just behind Andree Melly, who is two behind our equal leader, still Derek Nimmo and Kenneth Williams. And Derek, your turn to begin the subject, My Dogs. Would you talk on that for just a minute, if you can, starting now?
My dogs are feeling frightfully tired today. I've been wandering around uphill and down dale, after 60 minutes, and I really feel very pleased to be sitting on this rather hard B-ditto-issued chair, sunning myself.
Kenneth Williams, the chair.
I'm afraid there was a hesitation,
yes,
there,
I'm
Derek.
Afraid you're
I'm
right.
Sorry to have to pick on that vulnerable point of yours. There you are. It's all part of the game, isn't it, Derek? It's part of the game, isn't it? You can't win them all. And I come bouncing up there. Isn't it amazing?
Are you ready to bounce on the dogs?
Yeah.
All right. It would have. It's such a change of character and pace, I get confused sometimes. Kenneth, a correct challenge, and you have 43 seconds on My Dogs, starting now.
I have had many dogs, but the most notable was a Manchester Terrier, a lovely little creature whom I had to take, unfortunately, to the vet because of falling hair. It was all over the place. I mean, you could stuff a cushion. And I tell you that with a...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
If your hair's falling out, you don't go to a vet.
If a dog's hair is falling out, you take it to a vet.
Oh, it's the dog. I'm sorry. He said his hair. I thought he said his hair was
the
falling out.
The hair of the Manchester Terrier
was
falling out.
Oh, I see. Well, I just looked at his forehead and I thought, well, yes, I can understand it.
If you wonder now why there are so many cushions in his flat, you know the answer.
Ah, yes.
They're all Manchester Terrier cushions.
Oh, I see.
Kenneth, an incorrect challenge. You get a point for that, and you have 23 seconds on My Dogs, starting now.
The veterinary surgeon said, well, the phagocytes here are tired, and the follicles, you see, are all laying about exhausted. And when you comb your hair, do you notice a few coming out? I said, yes, but you don't think of a bald dog, do you? I mean, nobody's ever told me. There's a bald dog. Look at that dog. It's bald.
A repetition of bald.
The Andree, a correct challenge. 4 seconds on My Dogs, starting now.
I've had several.
Kenneth
deviation, I'm afraid. I'm sorry. Hesitation, I'm afraid.
All right, Kenneth. 3 seconds on My Dogs, starting now.
So up I would go to Andree
Melly. Deviation and hesitation.
No, Kenneth, you have 2.5 seconds on My Dogs, starting now. Yes, Andree, you have a point for that. There's 1 second on My Dogs, starting now.
Junie's the one I've got at the moment.
I have to tell you that we have no more time to play Just a Minute, which is sad because we've enjoyed it and we hope you've enjoyed it as much. Give you the final score. Peter Jones was in fourth place. He got a lot of points. He was three behind Derek Nimmo in third place. Derek Nimmo was one behind Andree Melly, who was in second place. But two ahead of her was this week's winner on this occasion, the one and only Kenneth Williams.
Oh, good!
hope you've enjoyed this edition of Just a Minute. From all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch.
Present Kenneth Williams, Derek Nimmo, Clement Freud and Sheila Hancock in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Hello and welcome once again to Just a Minute. And we're delighted to welcome back Sheila Hancock to play the game with our three regular male competitors, and Sheila does always so well against them. Lovely to have you again, Sheila. And once again, I'm going to ask them to speak, if they can, for 60 seconds on some subject that I will give them without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject which is on the card in front of me. Let us begin the show this week with Clement Freud. And, Clement, the subject that Ian Mester's thought of to start the show is getting a lot of letters. Would you talk about that? 60 seconds, starting now.
It seems very unfair that I should be given a subject about which the chairman usually talks. He always says, I get a lot of letters. Somebody has written to me. Now, I do actually myself occasionally get letters. And what I'm very sorry about is that almost every one I receive begins with, this is the first time I've ever written to anyone on the radio or possibly television, when there are in this country so many hundreds of people from whom I would like to hear. Girls I knew when I was 12, even 15, men with whom I served in the army, cooks with whom I cooked.
Oh, that was a rather subtle pause, wasn't it? Hancock, your challenge.
Well, a repetition of with whom and hesitation.
Well, just take the hesitation, because it was such a poignant one. We want to know what he did with his cooks.
But I would like to hear from them. Yes.
Sheila, as you have a correct challenge, you gain a point for that, and you take over the subject, and there are 23 seconds left on getting a lot of letters, starting now.
Actually, I do get a lot of letters from people that I was at school with, and I'm always very delighted to hear from them, to remember those halcyon days when everybody was so happy. Sometimes I get letters that I would prefer not to, but occasionally they say that the boys on the team are very unfair to me, and I absolutely agree.
Clement Freud is challenged.
Hesitation, I thought.
No, your thought was wrong. I disagree. It was teetering on hesitation, but not enough to be awarded a point. So, Sheila, you get a point for an incorrect challenge, and you have 1 second left on getting a lot of letters, starting now.
Equally, some say
Clement Freud is challenged again.
That was surely more than a teeter. It was a hesitation.
Half a second is less than a teeter than 3/4 of a second. Sheila, you have another point, getting a lot of letters, starting now.
I am unfair to them.
So, at the end of the first round, Sheila Hancock is the only one to score any points. And Sheila, we'd like you to begin the second round, and it is coming out balls, starting now.
I imagine that Ian Messiter is referring to those debutante occasions when girls reach the age, I believe, of 18, and a great big ball is thrown in their favour by their parents, to which are invited all the young, hopeful husbands. And the mother hopes that they will make a good match. I think it is a pretty rotten custom. In the old days, a member of the royal family would be present and the girls curtsied at a Christmas cake.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Hesitation.
Derek, you have a correct challenge and you have 22 seconds on coming out balls, starting now.
The important thing is to enter your name in the newspaper in June to indicate when you're going to have your coming out ball.
Clement Freud is challenged.
Deviation. Much too late in June.
Quite right.
But he's not technically deviating from the subject on the card, because he might do things late, and therefore he's not incorrect in the deviation point of view, and he has 13 seconds on coming out balls starting now.
When I came out, I went along to see Mr. Hartnell and bought myself a lovely white gown with feathers.
Kenneth Williams is challenged.
Deviation. We never wore any gowns by Hartnell. It's all a load of rubbish.
I agree on that. He never went to normal. Hartnell. If he had, I hope he'd have sent him packing. There are 10 seconds for you, Kenneth, after a correct challenge on coming out balls starting now.
I had a 92-piece dinner service when I was first married, but of course all I've left now is the...
All I've left now is the gravy boat. Not been married.
Now, I got a 30 proper night with use of fruit.
Challenged you after the...
How dare he? He's always been impertinent.
Well, after your first marriage, he challenged you.
Oh, yes. Well, you don't know about that.
Well, as we don't believe that Derek had a white gown from Norman Hartnell, we don't believe, unless you can bring proof to the contrary, that you've been married more.
It's perfectly conceivable that I've been married. Of
it's
course
it is. It's conceivable. Same as it's conceivable that he had a white gown from Norman Hartnell, but we, as far as we know, it's not true.
I've seen him stripped. He's not got the figure for it.
We're talking about coming out balls.
Oh, yes. Are we?
I'm sorry.
Oh, I thought we'd left then.
But he hasn't got the figure for it.
Kenneth, as far as we know, you have not been married before, so... I don't know. Derek has a correct challenge in 5 seconds on the subject starting now.
I have a very loose pair of swimming trunks. And sometimes when I go to debutante occasions, I do find...
Yes, Kenneth buzzed you.
Yes, deviation. We really don't want to hear these details.
And I still believe that even though he went on to say that he wears them on debutante occasions, and no more did he get his gown from Norman Hartnell, did he get swimming trunks for debutante balls.
Of course.
So I give it back to you, Kenneth, with 1 second and 1.5 seconds on coming out balls starting now.
The most unlikely sound that's ever been pursued on this trip.
Well, once again, we begin a show. And at the end of the second round, Sheila is in the lead, 1 point ahead of Derek Nimmo and Kenneth Williams, equal in second place. And Clement Freud yet to score. Kenneth, it's your turn to begin. And the subject is What I Won't Stand For. Can you tell us something about what you won't stand for in 60 seconds, starting now?
Some people won't stand for the national anthem. I won't stand for women coming into rooms and everyone having to get up. I think a load of rubbish, they all want this universal suffrage. So I keep on sitting down. People say, here, why don't you get up? There's a woman in the room, you know. I haven't got any manners. I would say, no, they've been after these. What?
Sheila Hancock. Challenge you.
Repetition of woman.
Yeah, you put too many women in.
I wasn't even underway, you great fool. You're supposed to be given a chance to get underway. I wouldn't get up for you when you come into a room. I can't do that much for nothing.
Sheila Hancock, you have a correct challenge. There are 42 seconds on what I won't stand for starting now.
What I won't stand for is Kenneth Williams. He can be dropping down on his knees and I won't give up my seat to him. He can be crawling around dying and I wouldn't give him a chair. However, I might stand up for Clement Freud because he's nicer and Derek because he occasionally pays me a
Clement Freud is challenged.
Repetition of because.
Yes, after those nice things she said about you. 20 anyway. Seconds left for you, Clement, on what I won't stand for starting now.
What I won't stand for is people being unkind to goats. I think it's absolutely disgraceful. Some of the nicest animals that I've ever come across that produce milk, which has quality and is made into cheese, and yet there are people who are cruel, despicable.
Derek Nimmo,
different people.
Yes,
people
you said people before. There are 3 seconds. Well said, but not enough. 3 seconds, what I won't stand for, Derek, starting now.
What I won't stand for are coming out balls when I'm wearing my swimming trunks.
Derek Nimmo and Sheila Hancock are now equal in the lead, and the subject is now with Clement Freud. Clement, what I deserve. one person in the audience who knows what you deserve, but would you tell us what you think you deserve in 60 seconds, starting now?
I suppose what I deserve is to go to Finsbury Park swimming baths and meet a man who talks to me about veraculars. And then I would say, surely you mean a veruca, at which the chairman says, it is typical of you to meet such an ignoramus. But there are people, I suppose, who would think that I deserve points. There are those who feel I deserve to win this game, which you can only do by going on and not repeating yourself, neither hesitating nor yet deviating from the subject on the card, which is what I deserve, where I came in not all that long ago. In fact, it must have been less than 60 seconds. Otherwise, the admirable Ian Messiter, with his watch in his left hand, would have blown his whistle to signify the end of that stipulated period of time, which appears in the publication dealing with radio programs every week, often...
Well, I think I echo the audience when I say never was 2 points so well deserved. Sheila Hancock, your turn to begin. The subject is matters of little consequence. You don't like the subject. Well, bad luck. There are 60 seconds, Sheila, for you on that, starting now.
It is extraordinary that things that seemed important when you were the age of the little boys sitting up in the gallery become matters of little consequence when you reach the advanced years that I now have. For instance, I can remember being deeply concerned about my spots. Now I couldn't care less. It is indeed a matter of little consequence to me.
Kenneth Williams.
This is absolute lies. I know for a fact I went on the stage with her. She said, those spots have got to be on me. I want surprise pinks on me. I want all those spotlights on me. She was always on about her spots. She was always on about them. She loves her spots.
That's just what she said.
Yes. Oh, did she?
But you were talking about the spotlights and she was talking about her own personal
spots. Oh, what a ridiculous misapprehension.
So Sheila has another point.
Well, pull yourself together, Nicholas. Go on.
I think I can say the same to you. You've enchanted us all with your misapprehension. 35 seconds, matters of little consequence, Sheila, starting now.
It is a matter of little consequence to me that Kenneth Williams keeps interrupting with stupid remarks only in order to stop me speaking for the aforesaid 60 seconds, which one has to...
Clement Freud.
Deviation.
Why?
She hasn't aforesaid it.
You aforesaid it.
Sheila, you have, 23 seconds on matters of little consequence, starting now.
It is a matter of very little consequence that Clement Freud has interrupted me in order to say that I shouldn't have said what
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Repetition of interrupt. Kenny interrupt and,
Yes, right. 16 seconds left on matters of little consequence with you, Derek Nimmo, starting now.
It's a matter of little consequence to me that we have a great oaf for the chairman of this programme who sits up there week after day on this stage of throwing water over everybody and therefore sometimes you have to get more ammunition and to throw more water back at it.
I have never been present at a radio show like this in my life.
I must explain them.
Do I get a bonus point?
Very quickly explain to our listeners that when Derek Nimmo was so rude to me, I went across to threaten him, but before my threat had any effect at all, he picked up his glass of water and threw it all over me.
Most of it went over me anyway.
So, Clement Freud challenged during that process. What was it, Clement Freud?
Hesitation.
Give Clement Freud a bonus point for a good challenge and Derek Nimmo gets the point for speaking when the whistle went, and the situation at the end of that round is a very interesting one. We have restored order. And it is that Derek Nimmo and Sheila Hancock are equal in first place and Clement Freud is in second place, just 3 points behind. K Kenneth Williams, it's your turn to begin. The most unlikely character in history is the subject that Ian Mest has thought of. Will you talk about him starting now?
Well, this would depend entirely on your point of view. For me, the most unlikely character in history is undoubtedly Elagabalus. I think to come to the throne, as he did at 17, and send the portrait ahead of himself, all this makeup she had on, disgraceful raver. And when she did arrive, eventually was on this dray, with all these senators holding him up, because he swayed right the way back.
Clement Freud has challenged.
The double sway.
No, you said swayed, no, swayed.
Swayed, swathed, you see. In
oh,
the
come on, stop. A very good attempt, but I won't have it. Clement Freud has got a challenge, which is correct, and he has 39 seconds on the most unlikely character in history, starting now.
Perhaps the most unlikely character in history was Henry the 23rd, mainly because kings of that name stopped at the figure 8.
Kenneth Williams, a challenge.
Deviation. He says a character called Henry the 23rd. Well, it didn't exist, so it can't be discussed, so it's a deviation.
Well, I would agree with you. I don't see how Clement Freud can justify it. He can't. Kenneth, you have 30 seconds on the most unlikely character in history, starting now.
Well, there was this girl selling these oranges outside Drury Lane, and Charles...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Deviation has nothing to do with, his previous...
Doesn't
assertion.
Matter when he starts again, he can start again.
There's only one seven. Most unlikely
character.
You can
character. Only have one most unlikely.
Go back
unlikely.
To that same old boy who painted up who was 17.
He might be, in a very clever way, about to connect the two. You
oh,
didn't
well,
give
hear
him a chance.
Then.
Kenneth, you have 25 seconds on the most unlikely character in history, starting now.
And as he passed in his sedan chair, she cried vibrato, "How's your old tomato?" Because that was her way of greeting him. She was one of the most unlikely characters ever to exist.
Derek Nimmo's
he
challenge.
He hasn't managed to forge the connection.
One of the most unlikely characters in history is what he said. And I'm going to leave the subject with Kenneth and say that he's got 15 seconds to continue, starting now.
So she became the body slave and rubbing on the unguents for Elagabalus, the emperor, you see, who was only 17 and had all this makeup.
Challenge, please.
Repetition of Elagabalus.
Yes, all right. Clement, you have... he did manage to connect the two, you see, Derek. There are 8 seconds on the most unlikely character in history, starting now.
When I was at school, I thought Henry II was the most unlikely character in history because I...
Derek,
too late.
Nimmo's
revision of Henry.
Too late.
Wasn't too late at all.
Of course.
Why?
Challenge at the right time.
Oh, no, no, you can challenge whenever you like.
Oh, really?
He repeated Henry.
He repeated rather in the last programme.
As long as you do it in the same round.
Ah.
3 seconds for you, Derek, on the most unlikely character in history, starting
the
now.
Most unlikely character in history, as far as I am concerned, is Nicholas Parsons! Ah!
Derek, your turn to begin. The subject is long sentences. Can you talk on that for 60 seconds, starting now?
I think sometimes to impose a very long sentence upon someone is extremely cruel. For instance, the train robbers to be sent down, as I believe the expression is in the criminal world, for 30 years seems to be out of all proportion to the crime that they...
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
We're not here to listen to your views about the judiciary of England. Who do you think you are holding forth about whether their sentence was too long or not? What a disgrace.
But the thing about just a minute is you can hold forth...
So said you could hold forth.
I've just said
what
you
are
you
hold holding forth?
Forth?
If I hold forth anything to me on this programme, you'd offer me a glass of beer.
I've never
got a burglar alarm on his dustbin, this one.
I'm sorry, I'm still laughing at Kenneth's remark about the burglar alarm in my dustbin. I wonder how he knew. Kenneth, I've never heard anybody hold forth in this programme more than you about unguents and Tsar Nicholas and Nell Gwynn and oranges and goodness knows what. Derek, you have 44 seconds on long sentences starting now.
Of course, when one was at school, one was really discouraged from writing down very long sentences. One was taught to divide...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of one, that's...
Yes. 36 seconds for you on long sentences, Clement, starting now.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain is not a very long sentence unless you omit to use any punctuation whatsoever, such as when you speak, in which case it becomes an immeasurably long sentence. But, for instance, were one to go to the Battle of Waterloo, the scene of that great fight, which either the French or the English, and at this moment I really can't remember which, won in the reign of a Napoleon.
Derek Nimmo's challenged.
Five inns.
All right, you had the one, you have the inn, and from after this, please resist the temptation to challenge on ins and ones and ohs and ours and R's and A's. Derek, five seconds on long sentences starting now.
Oh, my lad, please be lenient with me. 9 years hard without the option. What a terrible sentence to impose upon anyone.
Derek Nimmo got quite a few points in that round, including the one for speaking when the whistle went, and the subject is now with Clement Freud. Clement, the things I get let in for. That's a nice subject. And I don't think we've got much more time. It may turn out to be the last one, but keep going if you can for 60 seconds, starting now.
Things I get let in for is the sort of subject on which I don't speak because it ends with a preposition which is grammatically totally undesirable.
Sheila Hancock has challenged.
Well, if he doesn't speak about him, let me.
So what is your challenge?
A deviation, because he said, I don't speak about it, and he went on speaking about it.
Yeah, but that's the whole point about the game. You may not speak about it, you may not want to speak about it, you may be finding it impossible to speak about it, but you have to try somehow to keep going, which he was endeavouring to do. So I think it's correct to give him a point and tell him he has 48 seconds on things I get let in for, starting now.
But on this occasion, things I get let in for does merit a small sentence or two in order to acquaint this radio audience with my ability to open my mouth, close it, waggle my tongue, flash my teeth on virtually any subject which is the Ian Messenger.
Derek Nimmo's challenged.
Deviation doesn't flash teeth, he flashes dentures.
I want 2 points for that.
Well, it's very simple. Either take him out and prove he's wrong. Clement, I've never actually looked inside your mouth, but I do believe from the shape and styling of your teeth, they are your own.
Could only be real, couldn't they?
You see so little of them behind all the fluff on your face that... we do know you've got them. I disagree, Clement. You have 29 seconds to continue on things I get let in for, starting now.
At the open-air theatre in Regent's Park the other night, where there was a charity performance in order that people might give money...
Derek Nimmo's challenge.
Order. In order that the audience can hear about it, in order the...
Yes. I think you said order before.
Yes, you did. In order that they can Last be week. Told about that I can flash my teeth and nibble my nose or whatever it was.
So Derek's correct there, and he has 20 seconds on things I get let in for starting now.
Oh, the things I get let in for, very often opening garden fairs, particularly ones for little churches out in the country. Oh, I'd love to go along wearing a big hat in my bird car, and I say, ladies and gentlemen,
Sheila Hancock has challenged you.
Who's Dick?
Does he wear the big hat with his heart no gown?
I don't believe you wear a big hat when
well,
you go.
Do I?
What?
Oh, no. I do. I've got a mist. What's my son? Haven't I bought a lovely big hat?
Well, the less said about that, the better, then.
Well, less said about that, yes.
Welcome.
10 seconds for things I get let in for, Derek, starting now.
Sometimes I'm allowed into public houses after closing time and I have the surreptitious...
Sheila Hancock's challenge.
Deviation.
Of course, to go into a public house after closing time, that's very
exactly.
devious. Sheila, you have 4.5 seconds on things I get let in for, starting now.
One of the things I get lit in for periodically is playing this game with these maniacs.
Derek Nimmo challenged before the sentence.
It's a very unfortunate challenge, actually, so take it out.
All right, if you stop muttering into your gravy and keep your water to yourself, and we give Sheila Hancock
another point. Do I get another point for
you
that?
Get another point for an incorrect challenge, which he couldn't think of. He was trying to get in with only 0.5 seconds to go. He failed, and you go for another 0.5 second on things I get lit in for, Sheila, starting now.
One of the things I...
So I was right. We haven't any more time, so now I will give you the final score at the end of this game of Just a Minute. Kenneth Williams did very well. We heard a lot from him. He finished in a very strong fourth position, just behind Clement Freud. But Clement still finished up 1 point behind Sheila Hancock. But Sheila Hancock with 4 points behind this week's winner, Derek Nimmo. Hope you've enjoyed this edition of Just a Minute. From all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The program was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by John Lloyd.
Present Kenneth Williams, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, and Amy MacDonald in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello, and welcome once again to Just a Minute. As you just heard, we welcome back Amy MacDonald to try and compete against our three regular male competitors of the game. And as usual, I'll ask them to talk, if they can, on some subject without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject. And we'll begin the show this week with Kenneth Williams. The subject we're going to start the show with is jury service. And Kenneth Williams, will you talk for 60 seconds on that, if you can, starting now?
This is the procedure in English jurisprudence whereby 12 good men and true are asked to give their verdict. And I have been present at the Central Criminal Court, or as it's more affectionately known by Londoners, the...
Amy MacDonald.
I don't understand how a criminal court can be affectionate.
It's affectionately known as the Old Bailey.
Well, nobody knows if a court is affectionately, do they?
Oh, yes, you can use a term of affection even for a criminal court.
Can you?
And that is how the Old Bailey's name arose. I'm sorry.
She's an idiot, isn't she? I don't know. She's got no idea. Lives in London and don't know that.
Amy has not played the game as often as you, and naturally...
She's played the game often enough. Look at her.
The whole purpose of the game is to try and score points, as you said, and that's what Amy was trying to do. She was unsuccessful here. You have another point for an incorrect challenge. You have 39 seconds on jury service starting now.
Of course, the best kind of jury is one where all the members are sane, level-headed, contemporary, conversant, and just...
Peter Jones on this occasion challenged.
Well, they would have to be contemporary. They can't have dead people.
That's, I think, a very good challenge. And you have a point, Pete, and you have 29 seconds. Now you take over the subject, having gained a point for a correct challenge. Jury service starting now.
I've only been called to the jury once, and I happened to be in America, and I had to pay a solicitor to plead for me and pay 4 guineas, I remember. That rankles still over the years. Never been asked to go and sit.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Repetition of asked.
Yes. Oh, correct challenge. 15 seconds jury service with you starting now.
Well, I think the juries ought to be brought up to date like everything else, and I think they ought to be decimalised. We ought to have 10 good men.
Peter Jones.
Repetition of ought.
Yes, it's a tough challenge.
But also, grammatical accuracy, because if they were decimalised, they would be subtracted by 1/10. You see,
oh, he's
that's
so
what
clever,
they would be.
Isn't
so it? Actually, it's not what you're saying, is it? You meant there should be 10 men.
Kenneth.
Oh, no, I'm wrong. It's decimated.
You were quite wrong. Would you like to...
Then shut up!
Kenneth, with one accord, we would all like...
It's a noble man that can acknowledge his own mistakes, isn't it? Isn't that a noble thing to have done?
Now, look, you've got half an hour to go. Don't shoot everything at the beginning.
Oh, no, right.
Don't, hold yes. something back.
You're quite right. Yes. I should. Yes, you're right. I need sedation, really.
You do, really. Yes.
I wish we could decimate you at the present moment so we get on with the game. Who challenged?
I did.
Yes, you had a correct one on ought. You had 10 seconds on jury service. Peter, starting now.
Sometimes the people can number 8 or 14 even when they are selecting
Kenneth Williams challenged.
This is only in a coroner's jury.
No, it isn't. It's when they're selecting Miss World and other footling things like that.
I don't, Mr. Chairman, would you refer to them as a jury?
Yes, they are often referred to as a jury.
Well, no, they are incorrectly referred to as a jury, but they are still, that term is still used for them.
Exactly.
And there are 5 seconds for Peter Jones on jury service starting now.
They all go into this little room and goodness knows what they do, and they come out and they give the verdict.
Ian Messiter blows his whistle at the end of 60 seconds of talk, and that tells us that the time is up, and whoever's speaking at that moment gets the extra point. On this occasion, it was Peter Jones, and he has a commanding lead at the end of the round. Derek Nimmer, will you begin the next round? The subject is oysters, and will you talk on them starting now?
I must say, I wait through June, July, and August for that wonderful day on the 1st of September when the first oysters arrive in which will dark.
Peter Jones.
Repetition of first.
Yes, I'm afraid so. Oh. And, and he was so excited about his oysters, it was very sad. Peter, you have 53 seconds on a correct challenge. You take over oysters starting now.
In the centuries long ago, they were the food of poor people and have since become so expensive that only the very wealthiest can afford them. And I hope that the trend may be reversed as soon as possible because they are the most delectable things. Although full of cholesterol, which I understand is bad for you, they are terribly useful, the shells particularly, for building purposes. Mixed with cement, concrete, they make things very strong. I found a lot at the back of our fireplace. And of course the pearls inside.
MacDonald has challenged.
Oh, he definitely started, didn't he? He sort of, you know, he did one of
that's
those.
An impediment. You shouldn't raise anything.
No, it was a definite hesitation. He wasn't.
Amy. He managed to switch subject matter in midstream rather cleverly without stuttering.
If you'd said boring, I would have agreed with you.
So, it was well tried, but I'm afraid it wasn't correct. So, Peter, you are 17 seconds left on oyster starting now.
Let us imagine for a moment that we are going out in a flat bottom boat looking for these delectable crustaceans.
Derek Nimmer.
Two delectables.
Yes, you had a delectable before.
Did I really?
I know you feel that way about them, and it tripped you up on that occasion. Derek, the subject's back with you. There are 10 seconds left starting now.
As Samuel has said, why is it that oysters and poverty always go together, which Peter Jones has already pointed out? But my wife must be the only person.
Peter Jones.
If I already pointed it out, then he's guilty of repetition. Moreover, he's using my material.
But he did not repeat it in this particular round. Derek has a point and 3 seconds on oysters starting now.
Stuart Island oysters, those from Sydney Harbour.
Right. The subject is now Peter Jones, and it is Birds of Paradise. So, Peter, your turn to begin. Will you talk on that subject for 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
Well, I never like this word birds with reference to girls, young ladies, or women. But if in the next world...
Amy MacDonald.
Oh, I can't stand that reference, you see.
What?
When they call girls and women birds.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I can't either.
That's the...
I don't know, Amy.
The subject on the card, Birds of Paradise. Yes. So he is obliged to talk about it, even if you don't like it.
But he was talking about women.
I know I was.
I'm agreeing with you. Wash your ears out, girl.
He was just about to agree with me, which I didn't realise.
And I'm just saying what you... I mean, we've got more in common than you seem to realise, Amy.
That's why he regrets...
OK, I'll let it go.
All right, well, you'll give him a point. That's very generous of you. And Peter continues for 52 seconds on Birds of Paradise starting now.
Well, he's false stuff. I've gotten terribly fed up with it.
Derek Nimmer, Charlie.
False. Not very nice.
Repetition of f-f-f, right. And you have 50 seconds on Birds of Paradise with you, Derek, starting
Birds of Paradise was a title play which was shown at the Garrick Theatre, starring the lovely Moira Lister and Mr. Robert Cooter, equally nice, really, I suppose, and translated from the French...
Amy MacDonald.
I'm sure it was repetition somewhere. I'm sure he said something twice. I know he did. No, he did. He did.
Yes, I said Yugoslavia 3 times.
No, I know I heard... heard something twice.
But he didn't actually repeat a word twice, so he gets,
I just thought he did.
Therefore, Amy, has another point for that, and there are 40 seconds on Birds of Paradise starting now.
It was about a lady who bought a riding stable.
Kenneth Williams.
Well, bought her, that was...
Yes, that was a very positive hesitation.
I think no one could deny.
No.
Kenneth, would you talk about Birds of Paradise, and there are 37 seconds left starting now.
I think the most singular example would be the loveliness of the expanded tail of the peacock, which gawly...
Eamon McDonald has challenged.
Oh, I think he's cheating, you see, because the way he talks, he's spreading it out.
What about the way you talk? Help us all. Ever heard a play that of yourself?
It's not as slow as that.
Absolutely farming. Raving, isn't it?
What a nerve. Way I talk.
It's a joke, isn't it? You're not going to sit there and see me.
Will you be quiet for a minute and let me explain?
I think it's about time we did hear Amy talk. And as you were going rather slowly, I'm going to be rather generous to her and say she can have a point for that and let her talk about Birds of Paradise. For 25 seconds, Amy, starting now.
They're beautiful things with great long legs and streaks of colour going through their tails, stretching for yards. They have long beaks and great long feet. But shall I tell you something strange? That one day somebody said to me, Amy, would you like to go to the theatre? And I said, oh, I would love to. And they said, where would you like to go? I said, I have no idea. So he said...
well, at the end of that round, Amy was speaking when the whistle went, so she got an extra point.
What an other strange thing that he said.
Amy McDonald, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is my last public appearance, starting now.
My last public appearance was particularly exciting because I was asked to sing with the Royal Marine Band. And I thought, this is something that is really unusual for me. And I had to go to Coventry to do it. This was the only problem. So I thought to myself, how do I get to Coventry?
And Derek Nimmo challenged you.
She's been sent to Coventry twice.
Yes.
Oh, but that was a proper noun. You can say those twice.
No, you can't. You can only say what's on the subject, my last public appearance.
Oh, so... I was going to win that one. I knew I was.
Well, I would have buzzed, but I wanted to know what happened. I'd rather know what happened to Amy in Coventry than win just a minute.
The whole of that marine band.
Yes.
Like that very famous story about the woman who had only been unfaithful twice. Yes. Once with her husband's best friend and the other time with the London Philharmonic Orchestra.
That's a bit near the bone.
Got a good reaction. Derek, you have a point for a correct challenge and you have my last public appearance starting now.
When I make my last public appearance, I'm going to take a very long time over it. I think it's a very good idea to make as many last public appearances as you possibly can. Some people go around for years.
Amy McDonald.
Oh, no, I've just remembered. I've done it wrong again because he said last twice, but you can say that, can't you?
Because it's on the card, yes.
Oh, I'm awfully sorry. Do I lose a point then?
No, you don't lose a point. He gains a point.
Oh, I see.
And Derek, you have 26 seconds on my last public appearance starting now.
If you mean in terms of being the last one that I performed, it was last night. Which
oh,
is on
I
the card.
Don't know, I've done it again.
Shut up. Trigger happy to all those Marines.
She obviously wants to tell us what happened with the Marines. She's dying to get back in again.
She keeps saying last so often.
I know,
that shouldn't be allowed.
I know,
it's every other word.
Well, we won't charge a point for that. And Derry, you continue with 22 seconds on my last public appearance starting now.
Stage the Apollo Theatre in Shaftesbury Avenue.
Oh, that was a definite hesitation.
Yes, it was, yes.
Definitely was.
Here we are, back to Coventry.
So Derek, I think, has helped her back to Coventry, and we're all going to sit now with gaping mouths to hear what happened in Coventry on your last public appearance, Amy, starting now.
I got in my little car and set on my way to the M1. Going along, though, suddenly, in the back of my little car, came an awful lot of smoke.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of my little.
Yes, I'm afraid your little came in twice.
Oh, I do say that rather a lot, actually.
Tell me.
Eric has a correct challenge and 8 seconds on my last public appearance, starting now.
And then I came out of my dressing room and there the audience were full and they saw me come on the stage and they all booed and said, get off, they didn't like me very much.
Peter Jones' challenge.
Repetition of stage.
Yes. 2.5 seconds, Pete, on my last public appearance with you, starting now.
It'll be probably in just a minute, and then I'll go out.
Kenneth Williams, it's your turn to begin in just a minute. And the subject that Ian Messett has thought of for you is Armand Richelieu. Richelieu... 60 seconds, what starting now.
What's
well, he was the most formidable man in the government of France under, I think, Louis XIII. And there was a conspiracy led by Marie de Medici to oust him, which he successfully got rid of, or whatever the proper word is. I can't call it to mind at the moment. He could say, one could say, no, I can't say.
Derek has challenged.
He's saying too much.
He's saying too much. 35 seconds are left for you on Armand Richelieu, starting now.
Marshal of France, Cardinal of the Holy Roman Emperor, and then this wonderful man who was a tremendous power, but thrown into the Bastille no less than 3 times, and then formed...
Amy MacDonald has challenged.
Repetition, he said 3 times.
We give you a point for a very good challenge, Amy, a bonus point, but leave the subject with Derek, and there are 22 seconds starting now.
His greatest hatred, of course, for Madame Pompadour was something which went through the whole of Paris for many generations. Fortunately, when she first got the king's affections, he was away fighting the wars of the Austrian succession, had this wonderful conquest in Italy, and that was the time he was made head of the armies I've just described before, do you see? But when he got back, she wanted to put him back into that prison in the center of the city. And...
Well, Derry kept going with such intensity and feeling on the subject that I don't think anybody dared to challenge it. Amy, it's your turn to begin. And the subject is what I was good at school. Can you reveal something of your school days to us in 60 seconds, starting now?
What I was good at school amounts to, really, if I want to be honest, practically nothing. But there were certain subjects I took more of an interest in than others. I remember in particular, and the reasons why, I suppose, could be quite entertaining, because I thought that French was rather nice, particularly...
Derek Nimmo, John. You were a bit too particular.
Right. Particularly, yes.
Yes, you were a bit too particular. And Derek has a correct challenge, a point, and 30...
Why does Kenneth look as though he's got a pain?
It's his way of showing the pleasure that he has when you're talking. He's overcome, he's transfixed by the your style and your delivery and your speech. And there are 37 seconds on what I was good at school, Derek, starting now.
When I was 5 and I was at school, I was particularly good in making models with plasticine, which I like to do very much. Little dolls I would construct, also elves and pixies. And I took part in a school play in which I played a gnome. And I went on the stage and people liked me very much because...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Repetition of stage. Didn't he say the stage?
Not in this room.
No, that was ages ago when I was talking about the other
theatre. Oh, I thought he did.
Wake up, Peter. We've moved forward a couple of subjects.
Yes, yes. I beg your pardon.
There are 20 seconds for you on what I was good at school, Derek, starting now.
I also like playing cricket. In fact, striding onto the middle of a green field with the sun blazing down on a summer morn for me was as near to a bird of paradise as I ever got at that time. And I would whack away at that red leather-covered ball and would go above the sight screens and beyond and everyone would shout, what ho! Well played!
So, Derek Nimmo was speaking then when the whistle went. He gained a number of points in that round, so he's taken the lead, overtaking Peter Jones. Kenneth, your turn to begin. The subject, hippos. Can you talk about Hippos for 60 seconds, starting now.
Oh, this is a pachyderm quadruped, and I believe the name derives from horse and river. The two are coined together, rather like philo.
Derek Nimmo.
What? I mean, hippos, hippos is just horses. Hippopotamus he's talking about, which is water and horses.
Isn't I know horse. A hippo, if you want to show off your erudition, Derek, is the Greek for a horse.
Quite, and that's
and
the
hippopotamus
subject on the
is a water horse.
Oh, the subject on the card, hippopotamus, is it?
No, the subject is hippos. And we speak and very, very colloquially in just a minute.
Well,
you couldn't play the game
horse.
Without being colloquial.
Well,
and Kenneth was being
horse.
Very colloquial and using hippos in its colloquial phrase. And I will not allow your challenge because I don't think it was correct. I think you're being too pernickety, and Kenneth has the subject still, and 52 seconds on hippos starting now.
They are divided into stallions and mares, and then there's another one that's called a gelding, and this was very mysterious to me until I met a lady who specialised in the equestrian business.
Derek Nimmo, chap.
Actually, if I may say, he's chosen to interpret it the way that you've already ruled was incorrect.
I never ruled it was incorrect. I said you can interpret your... You've been very difficult, Derek.
Can't have gelding hippopotami.
No!
Why don't you shut your great mouth and let me get on with it? I've hardly had anything to say in this show. It's absolutely disgraceful. I've come all the way from Great Portland Street.
I don't see why you shouldn't have a gelding hippopotamus if you could find a veterinary surgeon who was man enough to do it.
If you want to be... A... That's the best remark of the show tonight so far, Peter. Well done. You have 35 seconds on hippos, Kenneth, starting
then
now.
Then there's the wooden horse, which is used to dry the clothes, or, as in the case of...
Amy McDonald's child.
Well, that has nothing to do with either hippos. It's got nothing to do with...
No, you were talking about hippopotamus.
No, you can change your...
He's not been talking about hippopotamus at all. You just listen.
No, he's just
you great
been
big nana.
Your challenge is correct, and you
is
have
it?
A point, and you have
oh,
hippos.
Good.
And you have 32 seconds, starting now.
Two hippos walking down Regent Street on a Saturday morning. One turns to the other one and says, "Not very busy for Saturday morning, is it?"
Kenneth, you challenge first.
That's very good.
Yes, because it's deviation. No hippopotamuses are likely to walk there.
All right,
we waited to the end. End
I also, it's a rotten joke, anyway.
We waited to the end of the
Come
joke.
Come on, give me the subject, hurry up.
I would like to say to the listeners...
It's nearly the end of the game. If I don't get in here, I'll never get a chance to win, you
You're
big fool.
You're going to get in. But nobody can start lysing now. I just want to say to all the many listeners that we have, we waited to hear the end of Amy's story. A lot of people enjoyed it. You
well, we
didn't.
We got the end of it, didn't we?
Thank
I'm
you.
Sorry.
We got a oh, lot more than the end of it, and we have Kenneth with a correct challenge, and there are 27 seconds on hippo with you, Kenneth, starting now.
They live in rivers and marshy countries and are known for a snorting which produces a flame. This can be ignited, and in fact, Ted Ray actually is lit.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
I've never seen a flame in hippo.
Listen, this was conveyed to me in strictest confidence. I happened to...
I think he was referring to a flaming hippo with us in the sense that Derek was. I'm prepared to be proved wrong, but I don't believe that
it is true.
Well, I don't know.
Am I going on time?
No, I'm going to put it to the
audience. No, shut up!
All right.
They are herbivorous, you fool. They're a herbivorous animal. And in eating all this stuff, it's like methane gas in a marsh. It builds up a terrible stink, you know, and you can light it.
Derek, you know, you have... Derek,
pull
no,
yourself
you...
together. You're supposed to be the chairman. Take the game in hand.
I'm together. It's you who's falling apart. You've taken your jacket off.
Well, where are we up to?
What's that got to do with it?
Derek's got the flaming subject. And he has 15 seconds on hippo starting now.
While staying in the Drakenbergs, I went up to a mountain reserve called Schlichlui, and there I saw...
Amy McDonald has challenged.
I don't believe there's a mountain reserve called Schlichlui.
Really? Well, it was definitely...
pronounced, yes.
Yes, it was, and Amy, you have a very good challenge there for not a correct pronunciation.
Yeah.
And you have 11 seconds on hippo starting now.
Two hippos wallowing in the mud, and there it is flying in all directions, and one hippo turns to the other one and says... Funny sort of day for a Tuesday.
Isn't
Derek did actually challenge just before the whistle. What was it,
Derek? Day, a repetition of day. Oh, yes. It's funny called day for him.
Yes, she did say day before, when the other story of the hippos.
She meant Francis Day.
Oh, but that was it.
Derek, you have half a second on hippos starting now.
Omphalosis.
So, hippopotamuses gave us a lot of fun and a lot of aggravation for the chairman. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we enjoyed sorting out the problem. And I will tell you what the final score is now. Kenneth Williams did very well, even though he finished in fourth place. He was a few points behind Amy MacDonald, but Amy did do extremely well considering she doesn't play as frequently as the others. And she finished up behind Peter Jones in third place. But this week, a long way out in front was, once again, our winner, Derek Nimmo. We hope you've enjoyed We hope you've enjoyed Just a Minute. From all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by John Lloyd.
Present Kenneth Williams, Derek Nimmo, Clement Freud and Peter Jones in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Hello and welcome once again to Just a Minute. And as always, I'm going to ask our four favourite, most experienced and most skillful and popular male contestants of the game to speak, if they can, for just 1 minute on some unlikely subject that I will give them without hesitation, without repetition and without deviating from the subject on the card, if they can. We'll begin the show this week with Clement Freud, and the subject, Clement, is The Way the Wind Blows. Our audience has already started to laugh. A good sign. Clement, you have just a minute on which to go on that subject, and you start now.
The way the wind blows is measured on the Beaufort scale from gale force down to placidity, which is known as 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1, or in other words, strong, weak, pathetic. If you are flying an aeroplane, it is terribly important to know the way the wind blows, because there's a sock which is billowed out by the air passing in a north or southeast or westerly direction, and the
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, there was a hesitation. He was up in the aeroplane and completely lost with all his north, south, east, and west. Derek, you have a point for a correct challenge. You have 25 seconds. You take over the subject, The Way the Wind Blows, starting now.
People often refer to somebody saying that he goes the way the wind blows. And of course, it's a nautical expression, really. It means that you go in the direction of the wind with your boat, let your sails be set firm, and off you float across the sea being puffed along by a great big wind.
Peter Jones has challenged.
If you're in a sailing boat, you don't necessarily go in the same direction as the wind.
No, you don't. In fact, you try to get the wind behind you because you want to go. It helps
That's
you.
That's the way the wind is going.
I think Peter had a very good challenge there. You don't necessarily go the way the wind blows, which is what you made a definite
That's
statement.
That's what the expression is derived from, Nick.
Thank you very much, Derek. I will tell you that you have 11 seconds to continue on the subject, having gained a point for a wrong challenge, starting now.
North, south, east, west, and...
North, south. I mean, there's no such place.
South, east.
So your challenge is...
Well, I don't know quite.
It could only be one of three things. Hesitation or deviation, yes. This is often what happens in the game. It's difficult to get started once you've been interrupted.
Peter, I agree with the challenge. You have 9 seconds on the way the wind blows, starting now.
Behind Drury Lane.
Derek Nimmo's challenge.
Hesitation.
No.
Rubbish.
And you have 8 seconds on the way the wind blows, Peter, starting now.
There's a machine where they manufacture wind effects, and this is almost indistinguishable from the real thing.
As usual, the whistle tells us that 60 seconds is up. Whoever is speaking at that moment gains an extra point. It was on this occasion Peter Jones, who at the end of the round has a lead of 1 over Derek Nimmo. Clement Freud, Kenneth Williams have yet to score. Derek, would you begin the next round? The subject is cycling. Would you start now?
I awfully like bicycling. I do think it's a jolly good sport, don't you? Cycling, one abbreviates it to. Daisy, what can the answer be? Won't be a stylish marriage. I can't afford a carriage. You look sweet, and all the rest of it, you know, a jolly popular song, which invokes for me the feeling of mounting one's steed on a bicycle, I would call it really, with my little clips round my ankles. And off I go across the meadows and moors with a whistle on my lips and a great panting, puffing, blowing coming out from my stomach and my chest as I strain ever harder to go faster and even more rapidly over dales and through tiny little streams sometimes so I can see the minnows pump.
Clement Freud has challenged you. I imagine the applause was for Derek and the booing was for Clement's challenge. Yes. And what is the challenge, Clement?
Deviation.
Why?
The whistle would have come out of his lips by now.
The whistle was, I imagine, being created by himself. And so, Derek, I disagree with the challenge. You keep the subject. You have 16 seconds left, starting now.
Reg Harris was probably our most famous cyclist in this country. What a sporting gent he was. And, ladies and gentlemen, we should be proud that in this country we produce such famous cyclists and don't give them the recognition they really deserve.
Clement Freud is challenged.
Who's challenged? Who won the lot?
Repetition of famous.
Yes, and cyclist as well, because cycling is the subject. Clement Freud got in very cleverly with only half a second to go on the subject of cycling, starting now.
OBE.
Clement Freud was then speaking when the whistle went. He gained the extra point, but he's still in second place. Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo are equal in the lead. And Peter, your turn to begin. The subject following that one now is recycling. So can you talk on that for just a minute, starting now?
Recycling, yes. Well, if you can cast your minds back to May, you may recall that a manufacturer...
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
Two Mays.
And you can say one was the
it was the month of, and it meant something else.
Yes. But he said two Mays.
But it's the word. You used it twice.
Yes, quite. So you Kenneth... felt right in it, you did, mate. You felt right in it.
So, Kenneth, nice to hear from you. And you have 53 seconds on the subject of recycling, starting now.
Well, this is a process whereby something which was considered used, second-hand, if you like, is put through these various methods, you see, and then something else comes out, and that is also employable. No, I don't. No, ha-ha-ha is not a repetition. Don't be so ridiculous. Ha-ha-ha is a repetition. You might as well say breathing's a repetition. We're doing that, aren't we?
We haven't heard what Clement Freud's challenge is yet.
Repetition.
Oh, what, Clement?
Ha-ha-ha.
I'm afraid it was more than once. It was twice. So I must give it to him, Kenneth. I'm sorry.
Oh, well, if that's how you're going to play this game, we know how we stand, don't we?
Well, you sit
all
to
all right,
it,
then. You just wait from now on. You just wait, my boy.
That's right.
You just wait. If that's the way the wind blows, all right. If they're going to play dirty, I can. Don't worry, I come all the way from Great Portland Street. I'm ready for this thing.
You said just you wait 3 times, then, didn't you notice that?
And that's the way the wind blows. There was a lot of wind that came up then, I can assure you. Recycle, too. Clement, you have 30 seconds on recycling starting now.
In the second year that Wembley Stadium staged the 7-day recycling race, Reg Harris...
Kenneth Williams is...
Deviation. There's no such thing as a recycling race at Wembley, and we all know it. He's just giving us a load of guff. That's what it is, a load of old rubbish. And I'm not going to buy it.
I must be truthful. I've never heard of a recycling race, unless you're being very clever.
Well, of course
with the
there isn't. Don't
words.
Spend time on it. Just give it to me, dear. Come on. Procedural wrangles. It's ridiculous, isn't it?
25 seconds on recycling, Kenneth, starting now.
So this stuff comes out and is reusable. Now, this is a very good thing in a country like ours because, as you know, we're an industrial power. There's an awful lot of waste goes on. People throw their old suds out.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Repetition of people.
Yes, I'm afraid there was, and Peter has the subject, and there are 12 seconds on recycling, Peter, starting now.
You may remember this man I was telling you about gave it as his opinion.
Derek Nimmo.
Repetition of man.
Yes, you told us about the man before, Peter.
No, I didn't. I said a well-known... No, I said a manufacturer last time. That's why I deliberately said man this time.
Well done, Peter. You have 9 seconds on recycling starting now.
Said he didn't think it was a good idea.
Derek Nimmo...
Repetition of said. The man said that.
He did say that. You did say it said, you know... 8 seconds now for Derek Nimmo on recycling, starting now.
Reg Harris, ODE.
Peter Jones has challenged.
I'm getting fed up with Reg Harris.
So am
challenge?
I. I'm fed up
repetition.
With him. Absolutely right.
But he hasn't repeated Reg Harris in this round.
He's gone on. They've all been going on about Reg Harris. Yeah, it's so boring,
I
you agree. Know.
Who is he anyway, Reg Harris?
I don't know.
Oh, is he?
His father used to make the tweed. I don't know what.
Derek, you have a point for an incorrect challenge, and there are 5 seconds on recycling starting now.
Recycled would come out as Ger Sirar. OBE will be.
At the end of that round, Derek Nimmo has taken the lead. 2 ahead of Peter Jones, 3 ahead of Clement Freud, and 4 ahead of Kenneth Williams. And, Kenneth, your turn to begin. The subject, Leo the Zodiac Lion. Would you talk about him 60 seconds, starting now?
Those born under it have to be very careful when Mars is under Uranus, because you can have...
Clement Freud has challenged you.
What's that? What's he challenged about?
I'm sorry, there were 2 unders.
What's he challenged about?
Because you said when you're born under that sign, you have to be careful about Uranus under something. 2 what? Unders. You went
where's
under.
The unders?
You used the word under twice.
He didn't. No.
Oh, did
it was
I?
A mistake.
Yes, but Clement has been very generous and retracted. His
oh,
challenge.
How gallant. What a charming chap.
Yes. So you can continue with the subject, and there are 54 seconds left on Leo, the Zodiac Lion, starting now.
I got most of my information from my old friend Maudie Fittle with Fun with a Frankfurter. Now, a lot of people maintain, and rightly so, that this whole astrology business is a load of rubbish. I would absolutely concur with this. After all, what person in their right mind really believes that by not walking under a ladder anything...
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Deviation. Maudie Fittlefurter believes it.
But she's not in her right mind, obviously.
Oh, yeah, she's not in her right mind.
I mean, if she's having fun with a Frankfurter, how can she be in her right mind? Now, let's continue with you, Kenneth, on Leo the Zodiac Line, having gained a point for a wrong challenge, and there are 27 seconds left, starting now.
There are those who maintain that this sign is signified...
Kevin Foy is challenged.
Repetition of those.
Yes, more than once. Clement, Leo the Zodiac Line, starting now.
Rupert the Red-Nosed Reindeer is a very close relative of Leo the Zodiac Lion.
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Deviation, I firmly deny that. How can a reindeer be a relation of a lion? Rubbish. He knows it's rubbish. But just because he was at school with you and was your prefect, he thinks he can perennially boss you about, that's why.
No, I think you're the one who thinks...
How can a lion be a relative of a... of a reindeer, Nick.
I quite agree.
Oh,
I haven't opened
oh,
my
right,
mouth.
Then,
you haven't given me a chance.
I didn't just... mean a blood relative.
It's no
I'm
good
not
going to
go
get
into
it.
If I could be allowed to speak, I will make a decision. And I, this,
of course,
and I...
you're a lovely chairman. You're quite right, lad.
Yes,
go on.
I agree with your challenge, Derek. You don't have to try and force an issue.
No.
16 seconds for you on Leo the Zodiac Lion, starting now.
Peter Bull, a famous actor, once a little...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes,
absolutely
Peter,
right.
You
gosh,
have
yes.
13 seconds for Leo the Zodiac Lion, starting now.
If you buy a good book on horoscopes and search very carefully from one page
Right to the end.
Hesitation.
Yes, right. I'm afraid so. 6 seconds, Derek, on the subject starting now.
Thoughtful, kind, divinely beautiful. Those are some of the things that you might expect from someone who's born under this sign. Oh, God, you'd be wrong.
Derek Nimmo once again was speaking when the whistle went, and he has increased his lead at the end of the round. Clement Freud, your turn to begin. The subject, my favourite author. Can you talk about him for just a minute, starting now?
It's no easy matter to come out just like that and say, my favourite author, because it could have been Reg Harris on cycling, or Shakespeare, Shelley, Keats, Wordsworth, Longfellow, Galsworthy. In fact, it's no...
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes,
nothing, in fact, not now.
Nothing. He couldn't remember who his favourite author was. There are 44 seconds left for my favourite author with you, Derek, starting now.
I think probably I would come down in favour of Lawrence Durrell, the writer of the Alexandrian Quartet, books like Cleo, Balthazar, and most important, I think, of the four, Mount Olive, which puts it all in reverse and frames the whole crossword for you. Gosh, I've read so many other things that he's written too, like Bitter Lemons, which I find to be the most inspiring book because I served in Cyprus for His Majesty the King from 1950 to 51.
Kenneth Williams, a chap.
Deviation is serving for in the forces for Her Majesty or His Majesty or whoever it is nothing to do with favourite authors.
Well done, Kenneth. You have 18
seconds
on my...
Bitter Lemons is about Cyprus during that time, actually, if I may say.
I know, but he had a very good point, and we haven't heard from him for a bit. So he has 18 seconds.
I don't know that I want under those circumstances. You're being very...
You are being
very patronizing, you know.
I'm not just a load of rubbish.
I'm not going to be treated like that. I'm not coming along here. I mean, I'm here,
Kenneth,
in a sense.
I think you have an excellent challenge. I'm being patronising to him, if anybody. There are 18 seconds for you on my favourite author, starting now.
Well, it's completely thrown me, but I will go on as best I can.
And Clement Freud has challenged.
Deviation, what? He hasn't talked about his favourite author.
No, but he's just about to. He said it's thrown him, he will go on as best he can, and he's now coming to his favourite author. He has 13 seconds on the subject, starting now.
He wrote the sentence, "The violet hush of evening was descending, as violet hush drove me along Sunset
Clement
Boulevard."
Freud is challenged.
Repetition of violence.
Well, you're just a fool, because you missed a very good line, you see. You just ruined it. It's S.J. Perelman, that is your great nit.
Can you give us the rest of the line?
And then No, not now.
Can I apologize?
No, 6 seconds for you, Clement, on my favourite author, starting now.
Henry William James, a man born in Manhattan at the turn of the century.
Derek, your turn to begin. The subject, Betty Martin. Can you talk for just a minute on that for starting now?
Betty Martin, all my eye and Betty Martin. That's the interesting phrase. Now, when one tries to find the derivation of it, one has to go back to nautical times in the 18th century when sailors of this great...
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
When one tries to find a derivation, one has to go back, one sail. I mean, it's an awful lot of ones, isn't it?
Yes.
Repetition, I'm afraid, darling.
And
sorry, darling.
46 seconds on Betty Martin with you, Kenneth, starting now.
She is, of course, inseparable from the optic orb. We all know this expression. It's a delightful one and signifies that what we're hearing or what has been related or narrated... wait a minute, what's
Andy challenged?
Got his oar in too many times.
You've got him on his ones, he's got you on your oars. There are 32 seconds with you, Derek, on Betty Martin, starting now.
Beati Martin.
Kenneth Moon's a challenge.
Hesitation.
Hesitation is correct, Kenneth, and you have 30 seconds to continue with Betty Martin, starting now.
There was a Betty Martin who I had the fortune to act with in a pantomime at school once. It was based on the Milne Rose and the Ring. It was rather amusing, really, because she wore this terrible wig, and it was full of what I imagined were diamonds, but turned out to be bits of old tinsel, do you see? I attempted in the third act to disarrange this headgear by shoving into her face a feather duster, which was on the end of a long stick. I had used it considerably.
Well, Kenneth Williams got a lot of points in that round, including one for speaking when the whistle went. He has moved forward into a strong second place, only two behind Derek Nimmo. Isn't it exciting? What will happen now as we continue this contest with Peter Jones on the subject of airships? For just a minute, if you can, Peter, starting now.
Well, I think it's high time that they were reappraised and possibly brought back into service. A marvellous way of getting from one place to another. Lighter than air, very quiet and comfortable they were. Now that the...
Derek Nimmo challenge first.
Hesitation.
Yes, Derek, airships is now with you, and there are 42 seconds left, starting now.
I always remember my grandmother telling me about an airship attack on Stanton, which is near Ilkeston in Derbyshire. Apparently, the great Zeppelins came over and dropped a bomb. And as I sat on her knee, she sang to me, "Cuckoo, cherry tree."
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
I can't have challenged. I'm talking.
I liked all that cuckoo cherry tree. I thought it was nice.
Clement, what was your challenge?
Repetition, but perhaps cuckoo was, in fact, one word.
Generally.
Cuckoo. What is
cuckoo?
Generally is one word.
Why?
Well, cuckoo is one word. C-U-C-K-double-O.
Well done. That's jolly good, isn't he, can spell?
Well, you've got to help Clement Freud if he doesn't know how to spell cuckoo. 24 seconds on airships, Derek, starting now.
One of the lesser-known airships was the 172 with an R in front of it. Because why don't you know about it? Now, I ask you, standing in the audience, sitting wherever you might be, I tell you, because it flew over Istanbul in March in 1942. And nobody noticed it because there was a total eclipse of the sun at that
Peter
moment.
Jones's challenge.
I know several people in that area who noticed it. I had letters from them.
It wouldn't go on. I could believe that if it did fly over Istanbul, a lot of people would notice it.
Right.
But I don't know whether you knew them or not, Peter, but I will give you a point and 4 seconds on airships starting now.
The gas is now available and it's not inflammable, so why don't they fill?
Well, at the end of that round, Derek Nimmo increased his lead. Kenneth Williams is still in second place, Peter Jones third, and Clement Freud for once in fourth place. Kenneth, your turn to begin. The subject, Edward Lear. Would you talk about him or on him for 60 seconds if you can, starting now?
Well, he wrote these limericks, I believe. Things like "How pleasant to know Mr. Lear, who some people think ill-tempered and queer," and things like that. I can't remember the whole bit, but it was that sort of stuff. It always had sort of funny connotation. Very nice, I suppose, if you like that sort of nonsensical verse. I don't know a lot about him. I think he's 19th century. I'd hazard that. Probably Victorian old gent, you know, who went around dollaring, writing this old rubbish down on bits of paper. And I suppose posterity has rewarded him by binding all these pages together. And things like there was an...
Derek Nimmo Chan.
Repetition like things like.
Yes, I'm afraid so. 14 seconds for you, Derek, on Edward Lear starting now.
There was an artist called Lear who wrote verses to make children cheer. They never made sense because they were dense, but the Queen thought Lear was a deer, which was a nice rhyme that was written about him. He went to sea in the sieve.
Derek Nimmo was again speaking when the whistle went, increased his lead at the end of the round. Clement Freud, we are back with you. The subject, I'll see you again. 60 seconds on that, if you can, Clement, starting now.
The great thing about working on the radio is that you do always see people again. Look into the transistor or whatever other apparatus you have. Search carefully with your left eye and then your right. And I'll see you again when skies are blue again in the middle of the night. There are a number of songs that have words like that in some predictable order, sung in B flat major, or perhaps other notes which I don't know about because music is not a subject on which I'm ever prepared to speak with authority, let alone joy, amusement, or entertainment.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Well, I don't think he ought to speak about it if he feels like that, do you?
I don't know, Peter. What's your challenge?
Deviation.
Why?
Because you can't see people on the radio.
Yes, it was right near the beginning of
his Well, I know, and I sort of gave you a chance.
It's all right, Peter.
Really.
You made your point.
Oh, yes, thank you.
And we gave you the subject, and there are 23 seconds left on I'll See You Again, starting now.
Was sung, I believe, by Noel Coward and Orr, that marvellous companion of his who lightened Broadway for so many generations. She was, of course, Gertie Lawrence, the immortal musical comedy performer of all time. When she passed on, to the
Derek. Hesitation for the nethers.
Yes. 2 seconds, Derek, on I'll See You Again, starting
Evelyn
now.
Evelyn Lay, boo to her friend, is always.
I'm afraid we have no more time to play Just a Minute, alas. But let me tell you what happened. Clement Freud only just finished in fourth place. He was 1 point behind Peter Jones. Kenneth Williams was in a very strong second place, but he didn't quite beat this week's winner, once again, Derek Nimmo. We hope you've enjoyed listening to Just a Minute. From all of us here, goodbye.
Chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The program was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch.